Saturday night and I was feeling kind of sporty. Went to the bar, caught me a 40. Got kind of high and kind of drunk, so I kicked the ass of this little punk. Forgot my key, had to ring my bell. My mama came first, she said, who the hell? Wait, mama, wait, it's me, your little son. Before I knew it, my mom pulled the gun. I know who you are, but who the hell is that?
Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Directors Club podcast. I am your host, Jim Laskowski. And this month, we're getting a little scary, though I'm not sure if this is a filmmaker I'd automatically categorize as a horror director, but let's face it. He's made some films that are rather horrific and have some disturbing content. Joining me down the dark alleyway on the streets of New York is one of my favorite creatures to talk movies with. He's an accomplished podcaster, writer, commentator, a true blue cinephile. Welcome back to the show, the host of Supporting Characters, Mr. Bill Ackerman.
Thank you so much for having me back. I'm excited to talk Abel Ferrara with you.
And he's somebody that I didn't know if I would be excited to talk about because my earlier experiences with his films were not, I didn't dislike the movies I've seen of his, but I wasn't over the moon. I almost felt like he's been praised so heavily by guys like Tarantino or something. And I was just kind of, maybe my expectations were really high going into stuff like King of New York, especially, but, This is a hell of a director. I'm now a fan.
Oh, good.
I wouldn't go out of my way to say like he's in my favorite directors of all time list yet, but I am grateful for having binged on close to 10 titles, if not 10 titles.
You know, I don't have a list in front of me of everything that I watched for this, but I watched pretty much every credit he has on IMDb and one credit that's not on IMDb, except for the Miami Vice and Crime Story stuff. That's the only time I didn't have time, but I've seen a lot in preparation for this. And it's interesting to watch. When you deep dive, you get a real sense of just how, you know, vast, you know, his filmography really is. I mean, I knew that he had a lot of documentaries, but I never really did the deep dive into like his music videos before or the short films. And It's a really remarkable career. I already kind of went into it as a fan, but it gave me even like further respect for him.
Yeah. And you did this all the while going to the New York Film Festival, which we'll get to.
Yeah.
I'm envious of your ability to binge on just about everything, which is great.
It's exhausting, but yeah, it's fun.
Oh yeah, no, it's definitely fun. I just know that I experience some sort of like similar to what happens in the addiction, just like an existential crisis sometimes watching too many movies and going, is this really what I'm going to do with my time? Is this exactly what's going to be fulfilling in the long run? What does this all mean? You know, and I get joy out of it. It's not like it's a chore, but there are just these moments of, and it can happen even at a day job. It can happen in a relationship. It can happen in any instance when you've gone through a lot, maybe emotionally, especially like everybody has in the past year and a half. But sometimes I do go, who am I to criticize movies? You know, I'm just a guy. I haven't made I've made silly movies and home movies and things, but I've never sat down with a crew and done what these people do. So I should who am I to criticize David Gordon Green for Halloween Kills? You know, I feel bad doing that. Like I just didn't enjoy it. And you know, if other people do, that's fine.
Yes, some do and some don't. I kind of agree with you that it doesn't really work, but it's not, you know, it's not uninteresting, but I don't think it works. But certainly like who am I to criticize? I mean, I'm coming into this like, you know, having, you know, read much more articulate champions of Abel Ferrara's films than myself. You know, I mean, someone like Brad Stevens is somebody that anyone listening to this should familiarize themselves with his book, Moral Vision, or you know, my friend Chris O'Neill, you know, has written on Ferrara, and this, you know, people like Kent Jones and Adrian Martin have, you know, there's a lot of great writing that you can find on the work of Ferrara. I mean, we're just approaching it as film fans, and I'm looking forward to actually just hearing your thoughts on some of these, because I know, like we talked before, how you were not necessarily the biggest fan of films like Miss 45 and King of New York earlier on. So I'm excited to talk about this filmography with you.
And I do get a better perspective when I do watch a lot of his work in a row, which kind of bumped up TOMMASO. Is that how you say it? TOMMASO?
Yeah, yeah. TOMMASO, yeah.
Yeah, like that. It's, you know, I watched it when it was high up on your list. Was it last year? I think it was, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was last year. I think it like might have done festivals in 2019, but it was a 2020 release here theatrically.
It made a little bit more sense and had a little bit more weight behind it after watching a lot of his films. It's kind of why I saved it for last, because I thought like, oh, well, this kind of reframes it a little different, a little differently now for me. Yeah. And you know, that holds true for a lot of his latter films. I only saw a few of those, not too much, but you know, he's also someone that would be impossible to talk about every one of his works in one episode, but the essentials will be discussed, I think.
Yeah. 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 I found myself getting a little overwhelmed trying to like think of what to say about like all of them, cause I watched all of them and I, you know, we're going to skim over some more than others, but I'll do my best at least to put it in context.
Oh, you always do great. So I'm not worried. But I again, like I've been going through that. I don't know. It could be just a general depression of some kind where it's kind of like, I should really be doing other things to work on myself instead of binging on a bunch of movies or watching Midnight Mass, the new Mike Flanagan Netflix miniseries, which turned out to be pretty special and a great thing to watch this month.
Yeah, well, binging Abel Ferrara movies isn't really always going to be the recipe to get out of a depression. I mean, but it depends on which depends on which ones you watch, I guess. But there's definitely a lot of turmoil and struggle in his filmography,
which I think really helped in a way, because it's similar to when you listen to like Nine Inch Nails or The Cure when you're in high school, where it's kind of like, oh, I'm not alone. You know, in what I struggle with and feel. I'm not like a sociopath or a psychopath, but there are just elements of like, oh God, why is life this insane? And you relate to some of the things that the characters go through or what they say, or even, you know, Lily Taylor's addiction in The Addiction. As you know, people can, you know, easily say, I've been drinking too much and I should really, you know, stop and reflect and figure out why I'm doing that. But that's a movie we'll talk about later in the show. Mm-hmm. You know the drill. I want to keep things moving and get to the pre-show entertainment. I said, you know the drill. Driller killer. There we go. Very good. Why not talk about something cool that you've seen recently for the What We Watched segment?
Well, you know, it's funny because I saw 23 films at the New York Film Festival and I was trying to think what to talk about. I think you're going to actually bring up one of the ones that I saw, but the one I chose Ryusuke Hamaguchi is how you say it. I've never actually had to say it until
I've been
now.
Hearing a lot. I've been hearing this name a lot lately, and I guess he has two films out and about right now.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Well, I had seen Happy Hour, which was this 5.5-hour drama about these four women, and that really blew me away the year that I saw that. And then he did a film called Osako 1 and 2, which was, I think, probably my favorite narrative film of that year. Was that like 3 years ago? And then he had two films at the festival, and I think the one that's going to get the most attention is a film called Drive My Car, which is an adaptation of a Haruki Murakami novel.
Yes. Okay.
About a widower, you know, directing a production of Uncle Vanya, and his kind of various relationships with the collaborators and the young woman who's employed to drive him around during this, you know, this production. That's really amazing. But my favorite of the festival was Wheel of Fortune and Fantasy, his other film in the festival. And this is three self-contained stories, romantic stories. Like one is a love triangle. One is another relationship story, more about a plan to deceive someone, a kind of an act of revenge. And then the third is, I don't want to spoil too much, but just like the unlikely account of a reunion between old classmates. And there's nothing very, I mean, they're attractively shot stories, but they're not like overtly, like the style is not really the thing that makes these work. It's just, you know, that each story unfolds in this kind of measured, unhurried manner. And it's like just about performances and strong writing. So I could see it kind of getting overshadowed by the, you know, the Murakami adaptation, which is a little bit more of an epic. This is just a really solid, engrossing series of stories, and it's a little bit more subtle, but I thought it was just, you just knocked me out. And I saw a lot of great films at the festival, but for some reason, this one has stuck with me the most. And it's just, you know, scenes that are given room to breathe for long stretches of time. I mean, Happy Hour, the 5.5 hour one, I mean, has scenes that go on for a long time. Like, it's not like a lot of, like, it's not like one of those epics like Lord of the Rings or something where it's like a large canvas. Like, it's a miniature kind of setting, but it's just like scenes are allowed to play out for a very long stretch of time. And I feel like that's something that you see in Wheel of Fortune and Fantasy, which I guess just opened this weekend in New York. It might have opened in other cities as well. I don't think it's streaming, but I'd say to keep an eye out for this one because I could see it getting overshadowed. I mean, I saw some things like The French Dispatch that were also really good, but you know, you're going to hear about them. You might not always hear people talking about this one, so that's why I thought I'd mention it.
Oh my gosh. I think it's actually, I want to say it might be playing the Chicago International Film Festival. And it might be one of those that you can watch virtually. And if it is, I might just have to do that. Because, yeah, I think there were three titles I was considering. And that was possibly one of them, I want to say. But the others were the new Celine Sciamma film and
Petite Mama.
Yeah. Something called The Worst Person in the World.
Which is amazing. And that you're going to love that. Yeah.
I had a feeling about that one. I watched the trailer and I'm like, this looks like a gym film.
Yeah, no. I mean, that's, I could see that making, I don't know if it's going to be your top film of the year, because I think you might have already seen that, but I think it'll be up there for you. I think everything I saw, you know, The Lost Daughter, The Souvenir Part 2, Parallel Mothers, Unclenching the Fists, Vortex, Benedetta, Futura, The Girl and the Spider, The Power of the Dog, Come On, Red Rocket. Like, pretty much everything I saw, I would recommend to people. I think the one I wasn't crazy about was this science fiction movie that is on HBO right now. But everything else I saw was really good.
Yeah, that's funny. Like that little film from a director I love, I'm not that excited to see, though. Again, I know people who love the source material and worship at the altar of all things Dune.
Yeah, people went nuts for it at the screening I saw. Like, I don't want to dissuade. If people are excited to see it, you might love it. It just wasn't for me.
Yeah. All right. Well, good to know. You know, again, like, you just rattled off a lot of titles that I am excited to see as the fall continues here. And certainly there'll be award contenders and things that I will likely have access to in the future. So that's what's also hard about keeping the podcast going, and why maybe around November or even December, I will likely choose directors with smaller filmographies, possibly. The next one's already set in stone, I think, with Sarah Polley, who all three films I have strong feelings about. And certainly listening to her talk on a podcast about Terrence Malick's The Thin Red Line, that really got me, you know, interested in talking about her as a filmmaker. So there's going to be a lot to discuss on that episode. And I'm really looking forward to catching up with all these 2021 titles that are not directed by Paul Thomas Anderson. So,
yeah, you know, it's funny. I think like every year, like, yeah, it's funny. You hear sometimes people say, "Oh, it's a good year for film, or a bad year for film." In my experience, like, every year is a good year for film. Like, it just sometimes you have to dig a little further, you know, to find the gems. But I don't know if what I saw at the festival is any indication. There's a lot of stuff that's really strong getting released this year. And maybe it's because like certain things like The French Dispatch, or if you like Dune, you know, we're just sitting on the shelf through 2020 because of the pandemic. But it just seems like you have a lot of choices this year to see some really remarkable stuff. Great year for films directed by women too, incidentally. I mean, between Joanna Hogg's Souvenir Part 2, or The Lost Daughter, the Maggie Gyllenhaal film, or I think you're going to talk about one from one of my favorite directors, Mia Hansen-Love. But there's
Way to go. That's what you call a segue.
Yeah,
okay, well, I'm really excited to talk about this one.
Yeah, well, and I was going to say Titan also is, you know, divisive, but definitely, you know, I think a remarkable, you know, achievement as well.
I think so. That's up there in the top five right now of the year. I was pretty impressed by that one. I had a couple of experiences with new films recently that made me go, okay, I'm still in love with movies. Clearly, that was one of them, and another was called Dim Land. Which, again, I'm not going to talk about it at length here. I'm more or less inclined to write about that one, I think, because had a lot of weird thoughts about it, and most of them to be very, very glowing and positive. But it's just an interesting experience that I'm more or less, I want to discipline myself to write some actual sentences as opposed to ramble on about it. But I'm excited to ramble on about Bergman Island by Mia Hansen-Love, which is a film about a writer named Chris, played by Vicky Creeps. I want to say it's Creeps or Kreps. I should probably find out since I'm such a huge fan of hers now. But she's her character is working out her next screenplay, all the while kind of being a little unsure about the marriage that she's in. It's interesting because there's not like a direct like, oh, this, they're clearly not connecting, but at the same time, there's just something in the air. There's like maybe some anxieties going on, maybe just because he's already successful as a filmmaker and kind of renowned, and she's still struggling maybe to find her voice, which is really interesting. Not to jump way ahead in our episode, but I thought a little bit of TOMMASO watching this, because it is this really kind of personal and reflective story that becomes a little meta in a way. And I don't know. I don't know if she's gone on record to say like, oh, this is definitely about me and my relationship with
Olivia,
who Tim Roth in this movie could potentially be playing. But at the same time, it's surrounded by the ghost of Bergman, because they're on this island where he essentially settled down and wrote a lot of his work and made a lot of his films there. It's in Sweden, right? I forgot the name.
The island of Faroe, I think.
Ah, Faroe. That's right. Yeah. Yes. Yes. But yeah, I mean, it has them traveling to this island, and there's a festival celebrating Ingmar Bergman, who, like I said, filmed a lot of his most notable works there. And Tony, played by Tim Roth, is kind of, again, more a successful filmmaker, a little bit more self-assured. There's a scene early on of her like kind of struggling to get her ideas down while her husband has this notebook that's practically half full already, full of it's like sketches and drawings and initial outlines of maybe what his next project could be. And I think it's interesting, if you watch this again, look at the contents of that notebook, because I think they're hinting at things to come. But as they're advancing with their screenplays, like fiction and reality kind of start to merge a little bit. There's she's developing this story where we're introduced to these other characters played. Amy is played by Mia Wasikowska, and Joseph is played by Anders Danielsson Lai. And in a way, they are mirroring her relationship and her feelings in ways that kind of become a little more direct, more or less. And yet it's kind of ambiguous. I couldn't help but think of a little kind of like Hong Sang-soo, since there's like this little playful deconstruction and blurring of lines when it comes to reflecting what the artist is going through versus like the story that's being presented to us. So I often like think, well, every movie is personal. Every movie is coming from the artist's, emotional state at the time, their environment, you know, certainly what they've gone through in the past, all these things just sort of coalesce to tell some kind of story. And this is not something like adaptation, you know, where it's like you literally experience the struggle of a writer and that writer is literally named the screenwriter who's writing the story. But, I really got involved in this film in a way that maybe because part of me is still, it's more of like in the background of my life, but part of me is still like this aspiring screenwriter who wishes he could sit down and sort of map out all my ideas and turn them into something and actually make even if it's just a short film. So I sort of identified with Chris's struggle creatively and also feeling like a little intimidated by not just the fact that someone like Ingmar Bergman made amazing films. How do you measure up to that? Like, I think at one point, Tim Ross' character says to her, well, nobody's expecting you to make Persona, you know? And I like sometimes when I watch a movie, I'm like, well, there's just no way I can measure up to that. So I'm not going to sit down and actually try to write something. So that's probably why this affected me a little bit more, just that overall process of trying to, you know, just capture your ideas in a way that feels true and genuine, while at the same time I feel this movie is very true and genuine to, you know, Mia Hansen-Love as a storyteller, even though I've only seen one other of her films, and that was Things to Come.
Didn't you also see Father of My Children?
Maybe I don't. Oh, right. I did see that. I forgot about that one. Yeah, that's right. I did see that. Mm-hmm. No, you've seen all of her films. I'm sure you're a fan of this one as well, because it does feel like, I don't know if it's a summation of her themes and ideas, but at the same time, I think it's just a really charming and personal story about understanding the creative influences and the way we let them shape us and into the stories that we want to tell.
Yeah. I mean, I didn't sit down and really try to gather my thoughts on this one. I saw it as one of 23 films that I saw in like 2.5 weeks. But I went into it as a fan. Like, I mean, I think I was as predisposed to loving this as the audience for Dune was to predisposed to loving that, I think, when I saw that. But like, for me, I mean, she's as consistent as any director working now. I mean, every one of her films I think is tremendous, from All Is Forgiven up through this one. And I think I was a little nervous because it was her first, almost entirely English language film. And I just thought, like, well, how is that going to change? Is that going to make it feel, a little awkward? Cause I thought, like, sometimes when foreign language directors, like, make their first English language film, it can feel a little stilted to me. But this felt right of a piece with all of her other films. Like I didn't even feel the change, I thought it was completely involving. I love all the film within a film kind of stuff with Mia Wasikowska. Her films are so funny because they always feel like they're building towards melodrama and then just kind of coolly step away from it. Like they never really get into the histrionics that you think it's building towards. It just, I can see why they might be a little bit too intellectual or like detached maybe to like work the same way as like a film with like a good like soap operatic like emotional explosion. Like there's none of that in any of her films. Even the ones that are dealing with divorce or rave culture or like bad breakups, like it's doesn't like she doesn't or even suicide, like they aren't really like, I mean, even the most melodramatic scenarios, I mean they're coolly measured about those kind of situations. But I don't know. I think I'm excited, that more people could potentially see this one, because her last film, Maya, never really came out in America. Like I saw it at a festival, and then I think it might have just shown in New York as part of a retrospective, but I'm not sure what happened to it. You know, and we're going to be talking about it. We're going to be talking about a director who's got several films just fall into limbo. So I know how that can happen even with like major directors with movie stars and such in the cast. But yeah, no, I mean, I completely wholeheartedly agree with you on Bergman Island being one that everyone should check out.
Yeah, it's interesting that you mention the films that I've seen. They are kind of like unassuming and reserved, and there isn't, yeah, like an explosion of emotion that you would expect, or even just like, oh man, we're gonna really hash things out. It's gonna turn into Seasons of a Marriage, and like they sort of comment in that in this movie, like, you know, she's watching one of Bergman's films, and she's even saying, "Man, this is just too heavy." And I appreciate it as a work of art, and yet at the same time, it's funny, like her film doesn't become a Bergman movie. And just because you have this preconceived notion of maybe this is going to be super meta and turn into something that Bergman would do, that's not the case. And I think I found that to be a pleasant surprise.
Yeah. You know, there was when the French New Wave directors first emerged on the scene, you know, people like Truffaut would like assail the earlier generation directors for like making, I'm trying to think the exact way he put it, but like cinema of quality, like these very polite middle brow kind of productions that didn't have the exuberance and energy and danger of the kind of films that were exciting the young Turks of that Cahiers de Cinema, you know, crowd. They were like, in, you know, and I think that they just thought like, you know, the stuff is too safe and stuffy. And I think that sometimes there's a certain strain of French filmmaking that might be a little bit too restrained and, you know, I'm not trying to think what the word is, like maybe not austere, but just, you know, they're about like middle-class French characters, and it might be maybe too provincial to cross over, or like, you know, they don't have like the edge of like the French extreme kind of filmmakers. Like since I mentioned Titan, like they don't feel like, they are, as shocking or as, like outrageous as like some, you know, like Leos Carax kind of characters that are like a little bit madcap. Mia Hansen-Love and to some extent Livia Asias as well, like they kind of fall into a certain kind of more restrained French cinema that, you know, I don't know that you see as much of it anymore, you know, that used to be kind of a mainstay like of art houses in like in the 80s and maybe early 90s. I think even some of the Kieslowski films kind of fall into that. You Polish director, but something like Red, like things that are just classy, you know, highbrow entertainment, but nothing too wild or provocative. So I have friends that like think of Mia Hansen-Love's films as, you know, nice, polite films, but I kind of go for that. You know, like there's a place for films like that. I feel like even America doesn't really produce that many films like this anymore. So I don't know. I mean, I never can tell like what people are going to respond to with this, but you know, Mia Hansen-Love is one of those directors that's like, because she's a woman, like, you know, you see those like directed by Mia Hansen-Love t-shirts on people. So maybe this will be her crossover. She makes an interesting contrast to someone like Sofia Coppola, as far as like, she lives in this like privileged kind of like movie royalty world, you know, because of her, you know, partnership with Olivia Assayas, so because she's been an international auteur herself for years now, you know, and it, you know, her films kind of reflect that maybe privileged kind of point of view. But I don't think that's uninteresting as cinema.
Yeah, it's been done before, but I still found it compelling. And again, not unsure, but I would imagine this is a story that's coming from her own personal experience to some degree, I would think.
Yeah. And you know, you could put it alongside The Souvenir, which is,
that's a good one. Yeah.
Which I was on my mind because I saw the very good sequel to it. Yeah. So it's, you know, another self-reflexive, female auteur kind of self-examination film, but completely different. You know, I mean, they both, you know, are such films of those filmmakers as far as their own distinctive voices, but, no, I mean, it's one of my favorites of the year so far. And, yeah, no, I was really, not surprised because she's never made a film I didn't love, but, you know, hopefully the English language and the fact that, you know, recognizable to American audiences, stars, you know, maybe more people will see this than even something like Things to Come, which I guess is her most popular film so far because of Isabelle Huppert being, you know, pretty famous lead, and also the same year as Elle. But but a lot nicer.
I like that one. I like that one too a lot, actually. So
yeah,
is Eden still your favorite?
I think so, but okay, I mean, but I love Goodbye First Love, and I think that that's the one that I would recommend to you more than Eden, because Eden I love, but Eden, like I think I said on our, you know, 7-hour podcast about our favorite films, I think, you know, it's a, you know, it's a more surface level and maybe shallow film than some of her other films, but I love Eden, Goodbye First Love was what kind of made me a fan, and then everything has been so good. Hopefully, some of her earlier work, like All Is Forgiven, will finally come out in America. Because I think even the French DVD that I have for that is kind of hard to find. So I don't get why her distribution is so spotty still. But I guess that's kind of how it works for like non-genre films. Because I mean, you know, if she was making horror films, we'd have it on a Blu-ray from Arrow or something. But
speaking of which. I've yet to pick up a lot of the Arrow titles recently, but certainly there's a couple, if not more than just a couple, that have been released from this director that we're going to talk about, and he's the director of the episode, Mr. Abel Ferrara or Ferrara.
Ferrara.
I love doing this whole. How do we pronounce this person's name thing? That should just be like a drinking game on Director's Club. There's a line in The Addiction that I keep going back to when thinking about this director. At one point, Lily Taylor's vampire character says, "Self-revelation is annihilation of self." And I just think of the philosophy, like that whole film, it almost reminded me of like, is this like Waking Life with how much people are talking existential philosophy pretty much every time they open their mouths? And I know she's a philosophy student, so that makes sense. But you know, it's really interesting. It's kind of an outlier in that regard because it's so driven by deep thoughts and heavy dialogue and these characters reflecting on what it all means. But, you know, his films started out very differently, we could say.
Yeah, well, before we even get to that, I just was curious, what was your origin with Abel Ferrara? Do you remember the first thing you saw and what your initial impressions were going into this episode?
Well, the first one I saw was definitely his Body Snatchers film because
really?
Okay. I really loved the original and then the remake. And I want to say I might even watch it on HBO when we had a cheater box for cable. Mm-hmm. And it just sort of came on and, I watched it around the same time I was the age of the lead character. I think it's Gabriel Anwar. Is the lead in that. Mm-hmm. And it really creeped me out. I'm definitely not in the same league as praising it the way Ebert did. I don't think it's a 4-star masterpiece that has scary moments that are up there with The Exorcist, which is kind of like, calm down, Ebert.
Well, I've got something to say about that, but we'll get to that.
Yeah. But I mean, that was definitely my first Ferrara film. And, you know, that was like when I was, you know, just watching horror movies and watching whatever I could find on cable, not knowing anything about who this director was. And then, you know, certainly later on, just because I kept hearing things about Bad Lieutenant and King of New York, I'm pretty sure I just rented those on VHS. And those kind of wore me out in a good way when I first saw them. And I almost just like likened him to, I don't want to say a lesser version than Scorsese, but just, you know, at the time I was a little dismissive of him and didn't feel the need to like explore his entire filmography like I would with somebody like Scorsese. So, but that was early on. That was even probably before I saw Pulp Fiction or around the same time I saw Pulp Fiction.
Yeah. Well, I mean, those films all do come before Pulp Fiction. Yeah. Cause that's 94. And I think, the period you're talking about is like 93. So you could have seen them right before. Yeah. I mean, for me, I think I'm trying to remember if I saw Miss 45 or Bad Lieutenant first. I mean, they felt like such different things to me because one, I sought out because of Danny Perry's cult movies, two, Miss 45. Sure. And then Bad Lieutenant, I think, was a pretty substantial. I mean, it didn't make a lot of money, but it felt like a very talked about substantial independent film for 1992. And it was also one of those earliest NC-17 films. And it was Harvey Keitel coming off of Reservoir Dogs. So it was like kind of a Keitel resurgence in that early 90s. And The Piano was also around then. So I think I saw that because it was, you know, a talked about serious film of the moment. I remember, since we mentioned Ebert, I think Ebert was so moved by Bad Lieutenant that I think that definitely informs his reaction to Body Snatchers. Maybe he gets a little carried away just as a way of, like, sometimes he gets swept up in a film and then it bleeds over into the other reviews that he does for that director. I think in the 90s, I got a sense of him as kind of this wild man character because of his, like, a Conan O'Brien appearance and the Driller Killer audio commentary, the first one where I think he might be on heroin or something when he's doing it. It's hard to tell. But you get a sense of him as this kind of thug poet because on the one hand, he was the kind of person that, like, you know, would speak kind of philosophically in interviews, but he also was the kind of person that appeared to be, like, he was the kind of person that would wear sunglasses at night, like, inside. Like, he was always, like, you know, had this kind of, you know, image that was like Mr. Cool kind of director, but like in a self-conscious way, like it was the bravado of hip-hop or like certain kind of would-be serious artists. But like his films are almost always rooted in genre, which made him like kind of an unusual character. I mean, as far as like crime and horror type films, but he was coming at it from maybe a more self-consciously sophisticated sensibility. I think that that's why critics latched onto him early on, because he was this kind of, you know, noble savage kind of character for them. I mean, as far as like somebody that really felt like he would shoot his mouth off without any kind of warning, you know, and I think that this is always kind of made him.
This guy has no filter.
No, he really does not. And I think, I mean, you could compare him to, I mean, you could compare him to Brando or to Dylan or to Lou Reed as much as to Scorsese or Peckinpah or Cassavetes or Samuel Fuller, like other directors. Like he's a larger than life kind of character. And I think that that's kind of like him as a guy is like a big source of the cult surrounding him as much as the work. You know, this kind of street talking New York hustler that somehow is still alive and still making like multiple films a year, even though he feels like somebody that should have died long ago because of the drugs and because of the hard living.
Oh yeah. I thought of Keith Richards.
Yeah. Well, it's funny that you mentioned Keith Richards, cause like he made a film about Keith Richards in the '70s, maybe protesting his like recent drug bust or something like that. But like he is like the Keith Richards of film, like somebody that just seems like, you know, unkillable. I think that when I was first getting, you know, familiar with his work, I think as the films become more art house, I couldn't tell how much of it was deliberate and how much of it was the drugs. I mean, I say that like in a way that like I see it now that he is, you know, making deliberate choices, but like, you know, I couldn't tell when things became more and more obscure in the films that kind of follow maybe The Funeral, like when he stops working with Nicholas St. John, who we should talk about, but when he stops doing the screenplays of Nicholas St. John and starts becoming more overtly identified with the screenwriting, the films become even hazier and like a lot more less cuts, more dissolves. Like they become like a little bit woozier, like they become like like half remembered hangover dreams sometimes. I mean, not always.
I didn't see New Rose Hotel, but that was my impression of that.
New Rose Hotel is like that. The blackout is kind of like that. You know, and even, you know, but it feels like an extension of like he always felt like somebody, like you look at a film like Dangerous Game, which was completely attacked at the time, partly because of Madonna, no, mainly because of Madonna. But I feel like you couldn't, I don't know how you could ever release that through a Hollywood studio and not expect to get roasted, because it's like super obscure and personal filmmaking done like for a major Hollywood studio. But it kind of creates the impression that to make a Ferrara film is to live a Ferrara film. Like, you know, yeah. That like that the sexuality and the drug use and the late nights of just hedonism, like that world that he depicts in the films, that's the world outside the films that he lives in. And whether or not that's accurate or just the mythology and myth making of an artist, I mean, that was something that was always very hard to separate when it came to Abel Ferrara. Like it felt like he was living those films when he wasn't actually shooting them, in a way that like someone like Martin Scorsese always had that distance. Like Martin Scorsese felt like somebody that was like watching Michael Powell films, you know, and you know, had asthma as a kid and was like, you know, he would make films like Goodfellas, but he wasn't actually in the streets doing it. Ferrara always felt like he was out doing it. Like
yeah,
that was the
like a method actor, you know, like someone like Val Kilmer would just completely like immerse himself into the world of his character, to where he just like, I am this character and you must refer to me as this character. And I get that impression from Abel Ferrara, is like, I have to completely live inside this story. And they all, and it's just, it comes out in these really dangerous ways at times that you feel uneasy watching something like Dangerous Game. But he should be in conversation with guys like Scorsese and Paul Schrader. And not just because they work with similar actors, but they all depict New York at a time when it was very different. I also thought of Larry Cohen and his earlier films, because they were shot in this like verite style without permits or letting the crowds know that they were filming a scene. Because I think in Bad Lieutenant, you can actually see like a New York cab driver look into and wave at the camera at one point.
yeah. They blur the line with documentary in a way that Scorsese really didn't do. And I think the certainly the foregrounding of religious and spiritual themes, I mean, ties him to Schrader and Scorsese, especially the Catholic stuff. But yeah. I mean, yeah, he is kind of like that missing link between the New York exploitation guys like Bill Lustig and Larry Cohen, and it's a guy that made Basket Case and Frankenhooker.
Oh, Hennenlotter.
Frank Hennenlotter. Like between guys like that, coming from that exploitation, even porno world, and then people like Scorsese and Lumet and people that, you know, were doing these New York crime stories. And I think that Ferrara is so interesting because he starts off in the gutter, gets way slick under the tutelage of people like Michael Mann, and becomes kind of like flashy, and then sheds it once he has the power to shed it, and becomes like deliberately messier around the edges again. And a way I thought of someone like Jess Franco, who started off like making these like well-composed professional movies, but as he went further along, he was less interested in like the visual prettiness and more just like into the raw reality of the scenes, and like kind of blurring those lines, and they become maybe slightly more amateurish looking films at times. But you know, as a design, like it's somebody that knows how to make a King of New York, but Bad Lieutenant is what he wants to do now that he has the clout, you know. And Bad Lieutenant, you know, and not to say the Bad Lieutenant is you know, amateurish at all technically, but it's just it's more rough around the edges and feels like it's being lived in the streets, whereas something like you know, well, like his more you know, polished crime films like China Girl or King of New York, they feel a little bit more composed because they also have more time to get the shots. I mean, he has more money and he has to eventually start working with less and less money. But you know, he, being the hustler that he is, he still scrapes together these budgets somehow and continues cranking them out like several times a year, it feels like, his documentaries or features.
Yeah, he lives next door, I think, to Willem Dafoe. in Italy or yes. something. And that's like, hey, let's just go make it this movie. And, you know, even going all the way back to Bad Lieutenant, he wanted everything to feel spontaneous and in the moment and raw in ways that I think are similar to just improvisation and creating things on the spot, similar to, you know, someone maybe like Cassavetes, but also just, you know, just kind of going with the moment, because like his script for Bad Lieutenant was like 60 pages long and not even, you know, fully realized. It was more of like a collaboration between him and Keitel, and certainly Zoe Lund, right?
Zoe Tamaris, Zoe Lund, the lead actress from Miss 45 and the co-writer of Bad Lieutenant, yeah, and who an actress in Bad Lieutenant as well, yeah. And that was one of the only films that Nicholas St. John didn't do in that run of films for Ferrara. He couldn't relate to that spiritual uncertainty because he was certain, you know. But that's a thing. When we talk about, I feel like going back to the conversations we've had about people like David Cronenberg, or like even the conversation I had with Patrick about Wong Kar-wai, you know, you have to keep his collaborators in mind when considering the body of work, because so many of them come, certainly the classic Ferrara period, you know, is all Nicholas St. John screenplays. They almost all have Joe Delia soundtracks. They almost, like, there's only a handful of cameramen that are defining the looks of them. So there's consistency behind the camera beyond Ferrara himself, that kind of gives them a cohesiveness, and beyond the fact that he's, you know, at a certain point working with, you know, a handful of his leading guys, like first the relationship with Walk and then Keitel and Defoe, you know, is, of course, is like now become over time the major collaborator in front of the camera. But, you know, that, I mean, that relationship with Nicholas St. John, and Nicholas St. John, I think, had tried to get other projects with other directors going. But as far as I know, the only things he's ever written were Abel Ferrara films. But he feels like the other half. I mean, you know, as far as like those themes, like, you know, since you mentioned the philosophical angle of the addiction, like that feels so like coming from that guy, from St. John.
Yeah. Well, he was a devout Catholic, and that's why a lot of that imagery shows up throughout several of his films. But he didn't want to work with Ferrara on Bad Lieutenant because, you know, there was blasphemous imagery, or even just the central attack is something that didn't sit well with him. So I think that's why he bowed out for that particular film. But, you know, early on, he started out, I did not see his adult film.
I've seen it.
I'm sure it's funny that, because you sent me a link for a couple of documentaries, and he told that story in the Mulberry Street documentary about how the actors he hired, I guess, couldn't get it up for a particular sex scene. So he stepped in.
Yeah. I remember when I first got into Ferrara, like the whole notion of Nine Lives of a Wet Pussy, it felt like an urban legend. Like, it wasn't not even clear in the first book on Ferrara if it was an Abel Ferrara film, but it was like something you could get through Video Search of Miami, I think. Like, and I remember the description was like, "See Abel fucking," was like in the pitch for it, as something I read. But I was just kind of like, yeah, like what could it be? But and even now, like the Vinegar Syndrome Blu-ray, I don't think they're allowed to say Abel Ferrara's name anywhere on the packaging, though they like strongly imply it. and it's you know, unusually pastoral for an Abel Ferrara film. Like, there's a lot of stuff set in the country. I mean, it's, you know, one of those stories that's like, you know, a thin plot, like connecting a series of sexual encounters. I mean, it doesn't really, I wouldn't say it breaks the mold on the kind of storytelling, you know, you'd see in adult films. I mean, but there is a sexual assault scene set on the New York streets at night that feels kind of like a harbinger of things to come with Miss 45 and things like that. But it's worthwhile for completists. And I know that there are people that have some smarter things to say about it than I could say. I mean, it's interesting as a curio, but I wouldn't say it's like major Ferrara if you're trying to fill out what are the key films to see.
Yeah. And The Driller Killer is interesting, and it's not one we don't necessarily have to talk about it at length, but what a weird mess. like, and in a good way, and in a really compelling and interesting way, because there's all these like random sequences with just the band practicing, yeah. Or and I'm just kind of like, what does this have to? Well, I mean, I guess it's probably going to lead up to something, but it's this sort of like weird coming of age artist slasher. It's like a big amalgam of different things that I think was going through his mind and in his head at the time. It's a video. It was considered a video nasty, and mm-hmm. you know, these this band of artists and this one particular artist who decides to make murder kind of an art in of itself. But you know, we sort of watch him ultimately destroy himself, but also find a lot of catharsis in killing with a drill.
Yeah, I mean, there was a whole wave of films that were associated with the no wave kind of music culture of the, you know, New York in the late 70s, early 80s. And I think that Ferrara never really gets grouped in with them. I think, you know, Amos Poe and people like that, like Jim Jarmusch, I guess, would be the most famous person associated with that before you get to like, you know, figures like Nick Zedd and like people like that. But like Ferrara, to me, that feels like the no wave slasher movie. And I think that no wave films have a lot of talk, a lot of meandering, a lot of people in like cheap apartments, you know? And I think that Driller Killer as a horror movie is too slow and talky to really completely satisfy the exploitation movie crowd. I think that people that rented it for a Texas Chainsaw Massacre type film were a little bit discouraged with it, but it's not uninteresting as a Abel Ferrara film, especially because it's the one film that he, you know, is the lead actor in under the Jimmy Lane pseudonym. and I think that, you know, I mean, there was a whole mini cycle of exploitation films with psycho killers as the main characters around that time, like Maniac and Don't Go in the House and Fade to Black, even earlier ones like The Headless Eyes. But like, you know, Driller Killer kind of sits alongside those, kind of sits alongside you know, the no wave independent films that coming out of New York, and you know, a lot of talk, not a lot of drilling, you know, for a long time, a lot too much, you know, dissonant rock music probably for the average viewer. But one thing I was going to say is that there's a couple of themes you see carry over through you know, many of the films, whether, you know, in the earlier films, it's kind of like, you know, you have a fair amount of revenge or kind of people kind of taking power through violent means. And then after a while, you get a lot of stories about basically apologizing to people for the, you know, horrible behavior you had, you know, you know. But the thing, I think Kim Newman was the one that said the Driller Killer was like the first psycho movie that was like about money, that like, you know, it was financial pressure, not sexual pressure, that drives him on the murder spree. And it's like, that's something that you see carry over through a lot of the Ferrara films, is the money issues, you know, whether it be something like Fear City or Go-Go Tales, where it's like, you know, there's like an enterprise in jeopardy, or Bad Lieutenant needs money for the bets, or Frank White needs money for the hospitals, or, you know, even just, you know, RX Smith trying to get the ransom money. Like, there's always kind of like the need for money. Even something like Mulberry Street, the documentary, you know, there's a lot about like trying to get the money, trying to be the hustler, trying to work out the deals, you know, that is part of being that kind of artist. You know, so Driller Killer, you know, at least in that theme, kind of resonates with the more sophisticated films that come later. So it definitely has its place. And I mean, as far as like a dirty old New York film, it's got a lot of great location and location footage, and it kind of sets the stage for, you know, the much more accomplished Miss 45. But you know, it's definitely the era Blu-ray of that, I mean, has a lot of material that puts it in context, that, you know, if you're even a casual fan of that film, if you don't already have that, it's, you know, you'll only get further appreciation for it in that release.
Yeah, I'd be curious to watch some of it. It's in that category of maybe it gets too raw, too nasty. maybe just, I know, I'm not saying every film has to be pleasant to watch, you know, obviously, but there's just, I don't know. It's one of those that maybe I'll watch it again in a few years and have a different reaction to, which is the case for Ms. 45, because I think I saw it a few years ago, and maybe I just wasn't in the right frame of mind for it at the time. still struggling. I think I want to say it might have been for the Larry Cohen episode where I brought up with Patrick and the guests this weird feeling, and it's still a conflicting feeling that I get with revenge movies in general. And I remember just like, instead of doing a specific movie at the time, I probably watched a couple of films that involve people going after, I think I may have even talked to briefly about watching James Wan's Death Sentence for that episode. Mm. And how I just, Death Wish stuff and all these things, like all this scenario always makes me feel uncomfortable. And I think that's part of the intention. But, you know, it's like, even with something like Last House on the Left, a film I don't appreciate as much as you do, there is something about the thrill and the, like, my heart racing and the joy, quote unquote, in quotes, joy that I get out of watching people go after the bad guys in a way that, you know, isn't necessarily satisfying. It's not like, okay, I've gotten revenge, now I feel better. That's rarely the case.
Yeah,
but well, I enjoy watching it happen for obvious reasons, I guess, because these are the bad people. They've done this horrible thing. So clearly it's, you know, just this method of vicarious thrill that I get out of watching people enact violence on other people.
Yeah, and it's funny because I was thinking about vigilante justice just this weekend with seeing Halloween Kills, which is, you know, mm-hmm. you know, has the vigilante theme in that, but, you know, undercuts it by basically the message being that, you know, vigilantes can't stop, you know, this kind of threat, and it's all pointless and they all die. Spoiler yeah. alert. but you know, the vigilante theme, I mean, you know, you look at, you, since you mentioned Last House on the Left, I mean, that's a film that depending on how you read the ending, vigilante revenge, you know, justice does not actually solve the problem. It doesn't erase the grief and tragedy of what happened to the parents in that film.
Right.
You know, so it kind of undercuts it, same way that The Hills Have Eyes does. Wes Craven was fond of doing that. But, you know, something like Miss 45, you know, I mean, it's such a great hook because it really is as simple as repulsion meets death wish. You know, I mean, it's the victimized woman as merciless killer. And you do feel good about the initial people that, you know, she's killing because she starts off killing the kind of guys that you hate. I mean, but everybody in that city is so imposing. I mean, you know, between the photographers or even like the landlady, like everybody is just in her business all the time.
I know all those people just drive me insane. Like I can walk around the streets of Chicago and thankfully not get, you know, harassed. And I feel so awful that this still happens, that women still get whistled at or harassed. And, you know, I think that all automatically just fuels this anger that you know, men are this way, and to actually see them get killed in the manner that they get killed in this is satisfying to experience. But then you get to that party and it sort of subverts that. It sort of creates this, well, okay, this is, I mean, it's almost, again, self-destruction is inevitable and you're not going to feel the kind of resolution because you're still going to live with that trauma of what happened. And I know the argument for some reviews of the film is that it's almost too implausible that she would be raped twice in one day, which is really hard to, it's hard to watch, and it's, you know, it's awful, and it's, you know, it's not meant to make you feel good in any way that this is happening. But at the same time, I don't find that to be manipulative. And you know, it's clearly, it's just what happens.
And between this and I Spit on Your Grave, it's not nearly the endurance test as far as the assault scenes. I mean, you know, it's pretty merciful as far as such things go. Even I would say Dangerous Game has more tough to watch kind of depictions of sexual assault. I mean, it's Miss 45 really doesn't linger on that stuff, even though it doesn't. I mean, it shows it, but it's not. It's not what the movie is, you know, selling you. It's selling you the revenge of the character. I was thinking this time for some reason I was thinking of Valerie Solanas, the woman that shot Andy Warhol.
You know, speaking of Lily Taylor.
Yes, you know, it's kind of like Valerie Solanas as Charles Bronson vigilante. Yeah, but I mean, it's, I think if, as far as like that kind of grindhouse exploitation film goes, I mean, it's a contender for the best film in that category. You know, I think for a lot of people, it's for, it could be Ferrara's best film. I mean, it's the one that is the least, you know, arty and searching. Like it kind of is an efficient thrill machine. I mean, you know, even that, and it has such well realized characters. It has such a great use of New York as a location. I mean, it really feels almost like a bombed out war zone that they live in times. And other no places, kidding, yeah. But then something like the Halloween party shows like he has total control over the imagery and the mood and the look of it. I mean, the look of Thena as the avenging character. I mean, it's such an iconic looking character that I mean, Miss 45 might be the most. I mean, among my friends, I think that is probably the one that almost everybody loves the most. I mean, my friend Alexander Helen Nicholas wrote a great monograph on it. I think that, you know, people downloading this are more familiar with that one than maybe some of the more obscure later films. But yeah, I mean, it's I think a classic at this point.
Spoiler alert: it's my favorite now. the first time I saw this, I felt like a lot of the kills were kind of. I don't know. I wouldn't say underwhelming, maybe a little repetitive. And the ending sequence, the slow-mo, I was like rolling my eyes. And then there's a certain phallic imagery thing with the knife that I didn't think too much of that at the time. And now it's sort of just all clicked into place for me. That kind of highlights the futility of revenge. And yet there's this primal need to follow through on that impulse because you don't know how to process the trauma that you've been through. It's not like she's going to go to a therapist, right? You know, yeah. Like there's just it's so unfortunate. It became really sad for me in a way that brought to mind, it's a very different movie, but what Angela Bettis does in May, you know, that film is more about loneliness and isolation, but she sort of transforms at one point in that film to sort of get what she wants. And, you know, Thena just becomes this female avenger, not just for herself, but for women in general, I think. But at the same time, it's not going to solve the, you know, the macro level issue of the way men are. I mean, just, God, I like just the way those early on in the film, you know, these are just women going home from work and they're being leered at, they're being talked to in these horrible, horrible ways that I, you know, again, watching that just play out in of itself is really, you know, that's probably at the top of my list of things that really piss me off in the world. Just watching that happen. And the fact that like, if I was in that position, I might break down and punch somebody in the face, you know? Yeah. And I'm not a violent person, but that's kind of what gets to me. So, and then ultimately what happens, I think is really sad and really powerful. And, you know, you could make the argument that maybe the last image is kind of a compromise, but I don't mind that. I don't mind that choice to have the dog live, you know?
I mean, this time around, I thought of Carrie also. I mean, and Carrie, the revenge is so much like it really kind of all comes at the very end. I mean, whereas this
that's true.
Gives you more. I mean, it gives you what you want from that kind of film. I mean, like all the things that don't work about Driller Killer are gone. Like all the flab and fat are gone. Like it's just this lean thing that, you know, I mean, it's a short film, but it's just so efficient at delivering like a rich text to piece over, but you know, it works for the 42nd Street audience that it was made for as well. Like it's satisfying as a grindhouse film, but also as something of substance. That scene where like, you know, the cat calling kind of men, I thought of, you know, La Ventura and the, you know, the way that women can't walk down the street without men just imposing themselves in like, you know, just taken further. I don't know if that was an influence or not. And Ferrara was a big, you know, fan of people like Pasolini. So it's possible he was a fan of Antonioni as well. I mean, but it's such a different, I mean, and both of them use cities in such a great way to express their themes. But no, it's, I mean, it's, you know, I know that Quentin Tarantino talks about King of New York at length on a podcast, and you know, mentions Miss 45 being almost like an impossible high watermark to top. I'm not sure that he ever really tops it, but it's interesting to see the different ways he goes despite that, like, you know, hard to top like level he sets like so early on in his career.
Yeah. And again, it's not a movie about this sort of like justified comeuppance that's, you know, glorified in any way. It really presents this sort of mental collapse of a deeply traumatized woman. And a lot of Ferrara's films are focused on men, you know, and certainly their self-destruction. So I find this film to be a little bit more refreshing, and Zoe Lund's performance is pretty great, you know, for being mute, you know. She does a lot with body language and her face, and just a performance that really stands out in a lot of ways throughout all the films that I've watched. I like what Scott Tobias wrote about this, you know, with, he says, the mute Thana speaks through a gun, which is also the language of exploitation movies. And that makes sense, you know, and this is one of the stronger ones that I've ever seen that tackles that, that theme.
Yeah, no, I mean, I don't know if I have much more to add on it that we haven't already said, but yeah, no, it's one of the great films of the 80s.
Agreed. Yeah. In between the next film that we will focus on, he made a couple of films I think are pretty good. Interesting. I'm not sure if I have a whole lot to say. That's probably why I didn't really like make an emphasis that, oh yeah, we definitely should talk about Fear City and China Girl. But you know, I enjoyed watching them. I you know, he knows how to shoot New York so beautifully at times that like, I'm just kind of in awe of that aspect alone, even if the stories themselves aren't strong. Or in the case of China Girl, I just didn't find the central romance or even the acting from the leads to be that great.
No, I love China Girl, but I think that, yeah, I agree that the leads aren't the most expressive of actors, but it's not, I think with China Girl, so we touch on what these are. I mean, Fear City is like another New York serial killer movie, but now we're in the shoes of the characters that are being impacted by the killer more. I mean, so it's like a case where there's a serial killer attacking go-go dancers or strippers. And like I said, it's impacting the business that Tom Berenger, the main character, has been trying to get off the ground, you know, because his dancers are being targeted by this maniac. And then they have such an uneasy relationship with the police who don't like them. Billy Dee Williams plays the head police officer. So it's like there's this tension, and it kind of almost foreshadows the tensions in something like The King of New York, where you're kind of more with the unsavory element of New York as your main heroes, and the cops are kind of, you know, they're more flawed, angry kind of characters.
No kidding. Especially Billy Dee Williams in that one. Oh Lord.
Yeah. I mean, they're not quite the bad lieutenant yet, but I mean, it's a view of the police that are just as, corrupt. In their own way. Yeah. As corrupt or unsavory as the people that they're kind of, putting pressure on. So it's interesting thematically. It's an awkward, not awkward, but like, it's like him kind of rising in the ranks out of the grindhouses of Miss 45 and Driller Killer towards the kind of slightly more respectable mid-budget crime action type fare that would have been, you know, big on video in the 80s, and, you know, pointing him towards things like Miami Vice and, eventually things like King of New York. So it's a solid little B movie. If you were watching it alongside other crime thrillers, you know, of the early 80s, I mean, it would probably stand out more. I mean, put aside the other Abel Ferrara films of this period, it feels like a lesser work, but it's enjoyable enough. And China Girl, you know, is kind of a Romeo and Juliet, West Side Story-ish kind of tale of, a young guy from Little Italy, you know, falling in love with a young girl from Chinatown, and their relationship, you know, kind of flies in the face of this like intense tension between these two neighborhoods and the people that live there. But again, it's like, you know, themes of money and like how the moneyed interests don't want this conflict because it's bad for business. So like the working, you know, the blue collar types, they don't have that kind of like they the racial tension or the territoriality of their neighborhoods. Like there's just this this conflict that I think the film spends a lot more time on that than developing the romance. I mean, the romance is almost secondary, even though it's kind of front and center and how it gets sold.
Maybe that's what disappointed me about it a little bit.
Yeah.
I wanted to get more caught up in the characters.
It's really more of a bait and switch because it kind of, it promises this romance and it's really not about that. I mean, it's not quite as extreme as like Jungle Fever, where it's like, it seems to be about romance, but it's also about crack. You know, like this is like, you know, a romance on some level, but it's also a, you know, more about the economics and how moneyed interests are like involved in these kind of conflicts and turf wars. And I think it's enjoyable. Like I do kind of like China Girl. It was maybe the nicest surprise of what, once I've revisited in more recent years. I mean, having seen it on videotape, I got a Blu-ray of it from France, and it's like, oh, this is actually quite attractive looking film.
Oh yeah, but the location photography, the cinematographer, I forgot his name, is it
Bojan Mazzelli?
Yeah, that's it. Yeah. He's pretty incredible. I mean, watching this film, I was just like, it looks great, even if I'm not like caught up in the drama of everything that's taken place. I like the ideas more than the overall effect and execution of everything. And that was true of Fear City. Fear City was a little bit like, it was a weird movie to watch with my mom. But also it was just like, even she had to comment at certain points, there's a lot of lingering shots of naked women just sort of, and I know it's that world. And then, you know, the erotic thriller is of that time period, especially, would do that. So,
well, I would say that lingering on naked women is something that Ferrara does for most of his films.
You're right.
That's something that you find even in things like TOMMASO or you know, I mean, it's funny. I was thinking about this while watching The Blackout, which is one you haven't seen, but I mean, you've seen enough Ferrara to know that I think of him sometimes as somebody that has, like the way he handles sexuality sometimes feels like the cross between like an Adrian Lyne erotic thriller and like a Motley Crue video. Like it's really, it's, you know, it's slightly tacky in your face, like sexuality in such a way that it's almost, I wouldn't say it's parody because it feels like it's sincere, but it's just, it's real in your face.
To a degree that makes me a little uncomfortable, and certainly like even just hearing snippets of him talk during the King of New York commentary, the way he oogles women is a little gross.
Oh my God. Well, the Driller Killer commentary from the DVD is notorious. Cause I mean, he's looking at old girlfriends and just kind of, you almost hear him salivating. It's pretty unrestrained carnal kind of thing for him with the women. I mean, I don't know. I feel like a lot of directors kind of disguise that through talk, but I mean, Ferrara is really unabashed about it. But I mean, that does make something like Fear City feel, I mean, some of that is also just the requirements of the genre, but I think that film is actually shot to be even sexier than we got, because I think they cut the sex scenes out of Fear City.
Yeah, that's the thing too, is that the version that I believe I saw on Amazon Prime, I think, was really weird in that at times it would suddenly cut to VHS quality. Like it went from HD to VHS quality because maybe there were certain scenes that's the only version they had of them.
Yeah. Well, there's an R-rated and an unrated, but then I'm saying that there's also scenes that never made either cut.
Right.
And there's actually a few Ferrara films that have notably different cuts between the Bad Lieutenant being one and Welcome to New York being the other big one.
I read about that one. Hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was one of the longer ones that I didn't get to, but I'm curious about it, especially it's funny. Like even as I got to like maybe 10 titles, there were still like maybe, I don't know, a half dozen or so that I was like, I wish I had time to watch these. They sound interesting enough. And like even something, I don't know where I came across that, like, oh, New Rose Hotel is one of his essential films. And I really hadn't heard that from anywhere else. So that's kind of why I didn't make that a priority.
I didn't think that at the time. I've come around on New Rose Hotel. But we'll get to that. But I mean, yeah, it is a case where, I'll just say as an aside, I don't think he has any film that isn't worth your time. Like, I think that every single film of his filmography, I mean, negligible with Nine Lives of a Wet Pussy, but like of things that are directed by Abel Ferrara, you know, and not, you know, under pseudonyms, I'd say that every single film is worth your time, which I wouldn't say that about every director. You know, or even most directors I like, but I would say that of Ferrara. And, you know, it's funny because I thought about this as an aside also with Bojan Bozelli, the DP on China Girl, because you know what he shot later on that I know you love is The Rapture.
Oh my gosh. That's where I thought, you know what? That's funny because I probably mentioned that in my available running commentary over at patreon.com/directors.
So. Yeah, he shot King of New York, Body Snatchers, and China Girl with Ferrara. And then, you know, he did Deep Cover and...
Okay, well, there we go. That's a nice transition.
Yeah.
Because, holy cow, Lawrence Fishburne in King of New York. Wow. What a performance. But also, what the heck was my... I don't know. My brain is weird. That's the only conclusion I can make is that I saw this like maybe 6 or 7 years ago and went, it was all right. But now, I wouldn't say I'm on, you know, Tarantino's wavelength of calling this like an absolute all time, you know, top 20 classic in the gangster genre. But I really loved it way more on a second viewing. That's for sure.
Yeah, no, I really love King of New York. I mean, I think it's a lot of fun. I think it's the most accessible film in his career. I think it's got such a great ensemble. I mean, of everybody, you know, delivering really compelling performances. I mean, it's one of my favorite Christopher Walken performances. It's my favorite use of David Caruso in a movie. I mean, Lawrence Fishburne is fantastic in it. I mean, I wish there was more for Steve Buscemi to do, and even James Lawrence from Frankenhooker. I don't think he has any lines in it. I think that this one is probably one of the most discussed, you know, Ferrara films. Since I don't know, even though considering it's one of his most famous, I don't know what quite to add about it other than that it's, you know, one of his most beautiful and quote unquote professional looking films. I mean, it's the film that like feels like it should have been a hit. I mean, that's the one that I think took him out of exploitation movies, even though it's a crime film. I mean, that played at the New York Film Festival and kind of scandalized the audience. And it's hard to imagine that film scandalizing people now, especially considering some of Ferrara's other films. Like this being a controversial film seems a little bit bewildering to me, other than, you know, films that glamorize drug dealers like Scarface or whatever, like are always going to be a little bit controversial. But, you know, I think people forget that this film could even arouse that kind of reaction just because it's so beloved, especially, you know, in the home video era and Blu-ray era. I think it might be, I mean, it didn't get the same crazy reception that Bad Lieutenant got at the time, but I think it's probably Ferrara's most popular film and probably Walken's most popular lead performance. I would think this overshadows The Dead Zone and,
Probably right. Yeah. But it's interesting watching this movie now because I must have, I don't know how, again, it might have been something I came across on cable, but when I saw New Jack City, I was kind of, I loved the soundtrack. I loved just about everything about that movie at the time. I think watching it fairly recently, I was like, oh, it's good, but not a masterpiece. But when I was younger, I was kind of like, damn, this movie kind of rules, you know? But now I feel like, was the world not ready for King of New York? Because I think New Jack City came out a year later. Wesley Snipes performance.
I think it came out that year. Didn't it come out that year?
You know what? You're absolutely right. You're right. Yeah,
because New Jack City arrives right before Boys in the Hood. And I think that the one-two punch of those, and then you next thing you know, you have a mini wave of films that are dealing with like, you know, inner city youth and crime, you know, Straight Outta Brooklyn, Juice, Menace to Society, you know, et cetera. I think if King of New York had Wesley Snipes or Lawrence Fishburne as the King of New York, that could have been, that could have made a difference. I mean, as iconic as Walken is, I mean, it's one of his great performances, but I think they underestimated the audience desire for a black crime epic. And I think that that could have actually been a bigger film had they trusted that. I mean, it's one of the first to really, push hip hop as in a crime film that I can think of. Because hip hop in film prior to that was really kind of more like, things like Beat Street or Breakin', or either tackling the B-boy culture, Crush Group, things that like they didn't really play up that association with criminality, because I mean, even things like NWA were like still kind of new-ish and extremely controversial. So I don't know. I mean, had they pushed it being a black film with a Schoolie D kind of soundtrack, I mean, I don't know if they would have been ahead of the curve of what became a really big trend. I mean, as it is, it's kind of like this imposing gangster picture, at the same period of things like Goodfellas, which, were made on a much bigger scale and got a lot more attention at the time. Like this one, I think that it didn't really open as wide as it could have. I mean, it opened doors for Ferrara, but from what I understand, it was not an easy thing to get made. And he walked away from something that became kind of big because he finally got the money to do King of New York and had to do it. I think it might have been Carlito's Way. It was something that became famous in its own right. I forget which one, but
that's interesting to think about. Yeah, because De Palma's another. But I mean, it feels like a predecessor to things we'd see way later on, like The Wire. Where it's like this juxtaposition of corrupt cops again, and yet part of you is rooting for the bad guys and the gangsters because they're a little cooler, But it's, I think what struck me a little bit more this time, and it's something that, I guess I should have picked up on a first viewing, is just Frank White is this white man running the streets and has, an army of young black guys that he's essentially controlling, but also really, friendly with. It's not like, I don't know if he's necessarily outright using them, but he's kind of just recruiting them because he knows that they can form an alliance.
Yeah. Well, he's also embracing them in a racist kind of crime world. Whereas, Italian gangs would, discriminatory towards Lawrence Fishburne. Sure. So he's kind of a progressive character as well as a drug dealer villain character. I mean, he's more likable than the police that are trying to stop him from getting the money to build a hospital. I mean, this is the complicated morality of King of New York.
That's predates something like The Wire or The Shield or even Breaking Bad, where it's kind of like, oh, there's a lot of gray areas here, and in a really interesting way. And like not to be dismissive and saying like, oh, he's this conservative Republican nightmare and he's out there running the streets like a sociopath, but he also has like these Robin Hood kind of good intentions.
Yeah. Well, it's funny because I the last thing that I watched in preparation for this was a documentary that he made on is it Pier Paolo, the priest that was like that built the Padre Pio. I'm sorry.
Oh, okay.
Padre,
yeah.
And
that's coming out. I thought that was coming out later. He's making another movie.
Well, he was trying to make a feature film on that, but he made this documentary in 2015 called Searching for Padre Pio. For some reason, it's not even on his IMDb page, but I mean, he's in it. He directed it. I don't know why.
On the Wikipedia, it says 2022 Padre Pio.
Okay. Well, this was like, I guess, like a research project sketch. So it's like him doing interviews with various people. I mean, it's a documentary. Like, it's like 55 minutes long. I mean, there's copies of it floating around if you look for it. But that guy also acquired a bunch of money to build a hospital. And as I thought about that, I wondered if that was an influence at all on that detail in the script of King of New York. And just as an aside, since we, it wasn't Carlito's way that he stepped away from to direct King of New York. It was Get Shorty. Since we met,
would have been weird. Wow. Well,
because we leapfrogged over not one of his more beloved films, but Cat Chaser with the Elmore Leonard adaptation, which is kind of an anomaly that comes between China Girl and King of New York, but the Elmore Leonard connection, that's where Get Shorty was offered to him. And had he made that, I mean, you know, that could have been interesting, but yeah, I think it all worked out for the best for everybody.
Yeah. Wow. I just, I don't know. That seems like a whole other movie to me, like Abel Ferrara or Barry Sonnenfeld. That's interesting to me.
They both started in porn.
Barry Sonnenfeld started in porn? I didn't know that. I just knew he was the cinematographer that worked with the Coen brothers. But okay, that's interesting.
He was a DP on old porn shoots.
Okay. Well, okay. DP porn makes sense. Anyway, so the cast, we've already talked about how great everybody is. Christopher Walken has the weirdest line deliveries, and most people know that. But in this, it seems to work. You know how I can't do a Christopher Walken impression, but it's like there's only one Christopher Walken, and just even the way he says, I love money. just things that make me laugh, and I don't like to just automatically go to, well, now we've completely reframed Christopher Walken as this comedian type character because of SNL and his success doing that type of shtick. But at the same time, and that's not true for something like The Dead Zone for me, because I find that to be a really sad, melancholy performance for a lot of reasons. But also here, just some of his delivery, it brought a smile to my face. And yet he's a complete sociopath at times, and the way he takes out that one gangster early on is kind of amusing just because he keeps shooting him even though he's already dead.
I mean, it's
so many great moments involving him that I'll never forget watching this movie.
Yeah, I mean, it's a great part for him. I mean, you need to have kind of a larger than life performance for that, a film like that to work with him at its center. I mean, I guess one thing I forget where he says this, but I think that Walken was giving Ferrara like fake Pacino kind of takes as well. Like, and I don't know what that really means or what that looks like, but I don't know if there's like an alternate cut of King of New York in Ferrara's attic that, you know, has Walken doing a more Pacino type big Scarface type reading of the character. But I mean, I think that reestablished Walken round two of his career, this as much as Bad Lieutenant and Reservoir Dogs helped, you know, with Keitel. I mean, I think that, I don't want to say they were adrift during a lot of the 80s, but I mean, the Hollywood of the 80s didn't really always know what to do with those guys. And I think that, Ferrara for certain, I mean, you know, capitalized on his connection with them as well as he could. I mean, they were both, you know, in consideration, I think for both of those parts, King New York and The Bad Lieutenant, I think Keitel passed on King New York or Walken passed on Bad Lieutenant. I can't remember which is which, or maybe they both, you know, but it might be the key Walken film, but I don't know. It's maybe a little bit debatable, but it's a lot of fun. I mean, I think it's the one that's easiest to throw on after a long day of work, because it's the most like quote unquote entertaining, you know, of his films. Like, it's the one that's like the least harrowing experience.
Yeah, I don't know why Ebert didn't like it. I know he said that the script was pretty weak, but man, there's a lot of great lines, and the joy of watching, you know, Lawrence Fishburne ordering, you know, chicken, and all like in the confrontation with him and Wesley Snipes, and just like and even I wouldn't say Abel Ferrara is a great action director, but you know, the chase sequence here, and even just the quick unexpected murder at the funeral, like there's just really solid moments that wouldn't be out of place in a Tarantino film, and it makes sense why he responded so strongly to this, and it sort of like fueled him at the time to you know, go forward with what he was working on with something like True Romance or Reservoir Dogs. Like, I could just see him, you know, the way I walked out of Pulp Fiction and felt inspired about cinema, I could see Tarantino sitting down to watch this and going, holy shit, this is, and everybody listen to that. I'll link it to it in the show notes, but there's a great episode of the Rewatchables podcast where Tarantino just sings the praises of this movie to no end in a great, entertaining way.
No, it's a very fun talk. I mean, they go over that in detail that we couldn't, you know, have time to do. Yeah, and it is, in a way, I feel like King of New York kind of closes the chapter on Ferrara, like 80s Ferrara, because, I mean, this feels like the skills he picked up in his television years doing Miami Vice and Gladiator and Crime Story, you know, like there's a sheen to it. I mean, even more than China Girl, I think it's a more substantial budget. It feels like a, you know, like the closing of a certain kind of chapter for him, because after this, he really transitions over into becoming an art house director. I mean, the New York Film Festival maybe gave him a little bit of critical boost, but he stops being, you know, the cream of the crop of exploitation genre filmmaking and becomes kind of like one of the enfant terribles of art house cinema, you know, with Bad Lieutenant. He becomes, you know, a different kind of filmmaker. Now, he doesn't really go back to making crime stories except, you know, with RX-mas and maybe one other one I'm forgetting, or The Funeral. But like, they're a different animal than something like King of New York, which is, you know, still aimed at the exploitation grindhouse kind of viewer. Like, it has to deliver the goods on that front as well. Whereas I think he becomes more comfortable with searching philosophical contemplative kind of beats in the films from Bad Lieutenant onward.
Yeah. It's almost like the final moment and image we get from King of New York, where Frank just closes his eyes and goes limp and dies. It's like, oh, that's it. That's all I could. That's a great note to end on with this style of filmmaking for him, you know. And like, first time I saw it, I was just kind of like, well, that was anticlimactic. I thought there was going to be a big shootout, or I thought that something crazy was going to happen. But no, he just, you know, sits in that cab and just dies. But now I find it beautiful and kind of remarkable note to end on. Like, it's very, it's like kind of, yeah, he has the shootout in the subway with the cop. As sort of like the final moment of confrontation. And part of me, but I think part of me was geared up because you see all these cops surrounding the taxi cab at the end. I'm like, uh-oh, something major is going to happen here. And then when it doesn't, I think the first time I saw it, I was disappointed, but now I kind of love it.
Yeah. I think, when you're in the same category as Scarface with the most operatic bullet heavy, you know, execution of a main character you could imagine, it's like there's nowhere else to go but underneath it, which is what they do in King of New York.
Yeah. And wow, Bad Lieutenant.
Not dissimilar ending.
Very much so. Yeah. It's so I'm going to say something kind of, I don't know, because I watched both cuts and I'm going to say something controversial, and that I don't mind the R-rated cut. Because that scene where he verbally assaults the two women in their car and then starts masturbating, I don't know if it adds a whole lot other than like emphasizing how despicable and pathetic and ugly of a person that he is. And we already know that by that point. And it almost slows down the film for me watching the unrated version and going, I wonder, like, the cut version. I mean, part of me when I saw it was like, you know what? I think there's supposed to be a scene that follows this, and I have a memory of seeing that scene. So why does it cut? And it makes sense why he has it in there. I just don't enjoy it. So
yeah, well, I mean, it's meant to be like
unpleasant.
So I understand, right. Like, it's really a more fun film without it. But it's, you know, I think that. I mean,
but like, just the whole idea of like, okay, what, you know, if I had just seen the R-rated cut and it just cuts there, it would make me think, well, what did he just do? And what horrible thing did, like, the whole, it plays out scarier in your head as opposed to seeing it kind of idea. And so I don't like, but at the same time in the R-rated cut, we don't get the, you know, nude Jesus Christ pose when he's getting high with the hookers.
Right, right.
And I love that moment so much. So it's almost like, yeah, let's make our own cut.
I mean, I think of that scene with the teenage girls in the car. I think of it like the gas mask scene in Blue Velvet. As far as like, an almost cartoonishly monstrous exaggeration of like male sexuality gone awry. I think of them in similar ways. Like they're so grotesque and like almost blackly comical if you step outside of just how horrendous they are. In Bad Lieutenant, it's really kind of more just verbal debasement. I mean, versus something like Blue Velvet, where it's like physical. Mm-hmm. Like, I mean, and it actually has an impact that's different from the actual sexual assault in the church. I mean, because it's prolonged in a more like, when will this end kind of way. But I don't know. It was unforgettable. I mean, I saw it at an impressionable age, so it's always kind of stuck with me. It's like such an iconic scene to me. It does show, a very ugly portrait of it. I mean, this is a real breakaway film in that, like, I don't know, had it not been so well received, if Ferrara would have like scurried back to more straightforward kind of crime sagas. But this is really where, I mean, you get the drug addiction theme a little bit in Fear City, but this is really where debauchery and hedonism become like prevalent on screen kind of, you know, material that he's working with. I mean, that there's almost nothing else to Bad Lieutenant other than just the debauchery and horrible behavior, and then that need for forgiveness, that need for grace, and which is something that I think both Catholic boys, Roger Ebert and Martin Scorsese, like, you know, went crazy over this film because of that. And also because, I mean, Scorsese had the history with Keitel, but like...
Same use of that song in from Mean Streets.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And that's such a beautiful song, and it makes me cry. And it's also like really sad that the singer of that song like unintentionally shot himself. That's crazy. Like there's, and obviously, losing Zoe Lund at such a young age, mainly due to addiction.
Yeah. Shooting up for real in the film too.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, and it's pretty prescient at one point what she says, you know, vampires have it easy. They feed on others. We have to feed on ourselves. And I'm like, oh boy.
Yeah.
I love that.
Yeah. I mean, setting up the addiction, and like you mentioned earlier, I mean, the real life documentary like quality of, real New Yorkers reacting to what they think is a dead body at the end. I mean, and just how they react to it is, you know, tells you so much about the world that, you know, Bad Lieutenant is set in, and it's such a great use of the city. I mean, I think this is not my favorite Abel Ferrara film. It's near the top, but it wouldn't be like in like spoiler like in my top three. It might be the most important work he did as far as like I think if King of New York is the most popular, this is the one that is the most. This is the Abel Ferrara film for many people, and I get why. I mean, beyond its commercial success, I think it's the one that sums him up, you know, maybe the best as an artist, at least this stage of his career.
I think it's elevated big time for me because of that scene in the church. We know the inciting incident, and it's really awful, and that assault alone is really, really, really upsetting. And he has a hard time comprehending forgiveness from the nun that was attacked. And for me, movies don't get a lot better when actors really get to just swing for the fences and have a true moment of catharsis. And certainly calling Jesus Christ a rat fuck at one point is pretty... audacious, to say the least. And right, I don't know if people were prepared for that entire sequence where he's screaming with rage and trying to understand why horrible things happen and why he continues to be a horrible person. And he's got to, like you said, aspire for some moment of grace and redemption. And his final act of redemption is this really interesting gray area, because on one hand, he's letting these rapists get away more or less instead of killing them. But he feels that maybe that's the right thing to do. And that kind of grants him some kind of humanity, as if like carrying out the wishes of the nun, you know, like just forgiving them and letting them go. And yet at the same time, they're horrible people for what they did. So that's always like a really interesting feeling I leave the film with.
Yeah, he's appropriating her act of charity for his own redemption. It's an unusual way to end it. I haven't seen this in a long time. Am I misremembering, or does Clockers end the exact same way? That Spike Lee movie.
Wow. Yeah, I haven't seen that in a while too, but I think you might be right.
I mean, I haven't seen it since the 90s. Yeah, I think Keitel has that same beat, but I can't remember the context. I just remember thinking, like, is this the Bad Lieutenant ending? But I think it's maybe Keitel's most powerful performance. I haven't seen everything he's done, but I mean,
nobody screams like that guy, man.
Yeah.
I can't even do it, but it's like,
yeah. Well, I was thinking that if you don't go with just how like that, like bleeding sound that he makes, like it could be an absurd film, because it does really go swinging for the fences. Like you say, like it's not a timid performance in any respect. I mean, it could be, I mean, you look at something like Dangerous Game, which, you know, has like some real scenery chewing acting, and this, you know, this plays it earnestly. I mean, that's the thing with Ferrara, is like, there's no irony.
Walks a fine line sometimes, though, I think, where it's, yeah. I mean, I wouldn't say like, oh, you could interpret a certain scene like that as being comedic, but I kind of reframe a little bit based on what you said about the assault scene as it being not, I mean, that's the thing too. It's like, I think even Ferrara even said that he thought of Bad Lieutenant as kind of a comedy, like a super pitch black dark comedy, like just his perspective on things is, I mean, again, he was on a lot of drugs at the time too. Mm-hmm. So who knows, but this movie, like I can see some people rolling their eyes or connecting with it.
Well, if you put it side by side with Werner Herzog's Bad Lieutenant, Port of Call in New Orleans, you know, with Nicolas Cage playing the character, I mean, that is playing as a bizarre comedy. Whereas here it's played jet black serious. You know, it couldn't be it's not ironic or hip, you know, it's like earnest in a way that is probably a little unfashionable. If you don't go with it, it's gonna seem ridiculous, even though it is blackly comical. As far as just like, I mean, I thought about something like Uncut Gems this time around, like just like that kind of that gambler's recklessness. I mean, but even like, and you never really hear Bad Lieutenant put aside, you know, alongside things like California Split or The Gambler or Uncut Gems, as far as like gambler movies. But it's
sad desperation that comes with that addiction. Yeah,
yeah, that addiction to losing.
Self-destruction again.
Yeah. You know, just like this, like the impossibility of the bets he's placing, and then just the, like every kind of indulgence. And you know, there's a few films that follow this that, like, you know, like The Blackout or Welcome to New York, that just, they linger on that kind of debauchery. And it pushes the limits of what entertainment, what's entertaining about it, but it just becomes kind of tragic in a lot of cases, which is like, you know, it's interesting. I mean, but I don't know if it's going to go for everybody. I mean,
well, lingering on debauchery is not something I get excited about in cinema. Like, I mean, it definitely happens. Even something like Requiem for a Dream, I appreciate. I wouldn't call it entertaining, but I think just because of the rhythm and the cinematic techniques and the editing and all that, like, I appreciate the way Aronofsky presents that story.
Yeah, but his technique is so slick that it grants you some detachment. Whereas I don't think if Ferrara had made Requiem for a Dream, it would feel more real and less like a well-composed nightmare. You know, like, I mean,
you know what film I'm surprised he didn't make is Last Exit to Brooklyn. I think that would have been right up his alley.
Yeah. I mean, that would have been interesting. I mean, he could definitely do something with that material, but I think he gets close to it in a way that, like, I mean, it feels like he is real close to those, like, moments. Like, he could cross over behind the camera and, like, you know, join in, you know, whereas, yeah, I don't know, something like Darren Aronofsky, I can't imagine him, you know, or I don't know too much about the director Les Essek de Brooklyn. Is that the guy that made Christian F? So he's definitely no stranger to debauchery himself. But
it's tricky for me. Like, you know, because then you have something like the Doom Generation. I'm just like, nope, I can't go there with these characters. I don't enjoy watching what they do. So, you know, there are moments with film where I'm like, it's a little too unpleasant, and if you're not giving me anything to lean on, and I think we had that conversation at some point about empathy, maybe for the supporting characters interview you did with me. But it's just like, if there's just this insane detachment or constant abuse, I kind of tune out and almost feel like, man, what are you doing? What's the point behind doing something like this? But, you know, and I can see people watching Bad Lieutenant and also feeling that, like, what is the point of spending time with this absolute, you know, train wreck, horrible human being? And then you have that scene in the church where it's almost like, oh, okay. Well, I mean, obviously he's still an unforgivable mess of a person, but there's still a need deep down, like, again, a sad desperation that you'd find in characters in the Paul Thomas Anderson movie within that moment of just like, please let me find a connection. Let me find, you know, why, like, just let me change, in other words, you know, and I might need help doing that too. And some people, that's probably why people do tend to adopt religion into their lives. And it makes sense to me.
Yeah.
You know?
Nice.
But and the final shot of Bad Lieutenant's interesting in the fact that he meets his comeuppance right outside of Trump Plaza. Interesting.
Yes.
But there's a lot of movies in between there and one of the more recent ones. So, I mean, we could certainly
touch on them. Just, well, you mentioned Body Snatchers already was your first one. And I think that's like a satisfying 90s horror. I don't think that it's better than the Don Siegel or the Philip Kaufman versions, but it's respectable. If you don't, like, you know, compare it with those films, I think it's the one that shows that Ferrara could make a commercial Hollywood big budget movie, and really he kind of disappears. I mean, you don't really feel Ferrara's influence on it. I don't know how much tampering there was. I know that D.D. Allen was brought in to recut the film after he gave his original cuts. I don't know how much the editorial process kind of removed Ferrara's voice. I mean, it feels kind of like Ferrara, but it's definitely the biggest anomaly on his resume. I mean, even more than the porno film or the anything else that he made, it feels like the most anonymous film, and shows what could have happened to him had his tenure in the studio system really took. But I think both this and Dangerous Game were pretty much buried by their respective studios.
And I've said this on two other podcasts before about Body Snatchers, and the most memorable moment for me involves Meg Tilly. That when she's talking to her husband, I just think that's really strong acting right there, and really creepy, and something has stayed with me since first seeing it. But, you know, It you could tell that also this version was definitely written by three people. You know,
one of them being Stuart Gordon.
Yeah. And I know Larry Cohen might have done a uncredited rewrite or something along those lines.
Yeah. It's, I don't know. I mean, it's an interesting idea, you know, to take away the small town suburban conformity idea and, like, you know, that whole notion of the body snatchers being relocated to a military base where there's already that kind of, like, enforced kind of rigidity to the behavior. Like, you know, it's an interesting idea. And I think it has some strong imagery. I think it works. It's always going to suffer in comparison to, like, two other well thought of films. So it's kind of a thankless task to remake that story. It's weird that they keep retelling it, but,
I think they should now more than ever. With the vaccine and Trump, I think like
social media, there's a lot. Yeah. I mean, there's lot to deal with the conformity idea, but it's fun if you, and it's the least Ferrara-like film probably of all.
Yeah, definitely the ones I watched for sure. Dangerous Game is one where I think he gets a little, I don't want to say self-indulgent because a lot of his films are, but I mean, like a little, maybe got, you know, high on his own supply, a little, I don't know. I had a push and pull kind of experience with it where there were things I really loved. And then there were things where I'm like, this is not working.
I kind of love it, but I can understand people not loving it. I think it came out the same year as Body of Evidence, and I think it was sold like an erotic thriller. I mean, they retitled it. It was originally Snake Eyes, and then they retitled it to Dangerous Game. And, like I said earlier, like it feels like it really it engages in myth building in a way because, I mean, Ferrara's wife is in it, and like, you know, Keitel is playing like a thinly veiled version of Ferrara. And it feels like it's about the hell of making an Abel Ferrara movie and the psychodramas that emerge on the set. Like it feels like, but again, like, it has those like video recordings of rehearsal footage incorporated in, like it's a all the weird documentary choices, which was really radical for like a 1993 Hollywood studio movie.
I found that to be really interesting. I like that element. I don't know. I know James Russo is meant to be over the top and crazy and bigger than life at times, but just him just like, I need these things. Need these things over and over again.
Yeah, no, it's a bit hammy for sure. I can't tell. I mean, but it almost kind of works for that character because he is too over the top.
Yeah, yeah.
But whereas Madonna comes, I think that might be one of Madonna's greatest performances as an actress, even though she
has a great moment where she does this monologue to Keitel at one point.
Even though she
something that happened to her.
Yeah, and she's the one that really kind of buried it. I mean, she kind of, trashed it in the press when it came out, and I think didn't help. And I think it's an essential viewing for Ferrara, you know, watchers, because it feels like it really is the earliest example of like really blatantly self-reflexive cinema in his work. I mean, this is something that you get more later with the Defoe films, but it's a very different energy with Keitel doing it.
But I also don't think it's Siskel and Ebert put it on their worst of 93 show, and I don't agree with that. I think it's more interesting than what they should give it more credit. I don't think it's entirely successful.
I went into it with low expectations because all I thought it was an erotic thriller that bombed and got bad reviews with Madonna. So when I saw it and it was actually about Ferrara, I was like, this is the auteurist in me. You know, the fact that this was the first one that was just kind of like really like blatantly confessional, I found interesting. And, you know, it's also confessional. Nicky St. John, you know, the same kind of thing. Like, you know, the wrestling with spiritual themes, you know, with the film within a film. It's maybe a little messy. I can't really argue with people that think it's overstuffed and self-indulgent. But, I think it's kind of hilarious that, like, you know, somebody could make this, you know, with the juice he got from Bad Lieutenant, King of New York, like to make something like this and expect the public to show up and pay for it. I mean, it's bolder than anything Cassavetes did or, you know,
Cassavetes watching it. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, Cassavetes films could be punishing in their length, so I shouldn't say it's bolder, but it definitely feels like stylistically as radical as anything he tried.
It's again, very audacious and self-reflective. And, you know, when we talk about like kind of a film within a film, I couldn't help but think Bergman Island is Hansen-Love. that's her Dangerous Game. Like, and then you get, you know, spending time in the mind of Abel Ferrara in this world is challenging.
Yes. Well, this definitely feels like a period where the drugs inform the art in a way that, you know,
yeah,
the indulgences, you can't tell how much of that is chemically induced. I mean, so the next film, you know, after that, which we also touched on, was The Addiction, which is an interesting companion in some ways to Miss 45, although it's, you know, it's not something I initially thought of when I saw it. I saw it on it back to back with Nadja, the other black and white indie vampire movie.
That's so weird because I put that in my notes as like, you know, I got to revisit Nadja because that's what this movie made me think of.
Yeah. I mean, this is like another vampire movie as drug addiction metaphor, kind of like Martin or Death Dream, or there's a Larry Fessenden film called Habit from around this time. I mean, there's a couple of things that do this, but I don't know that any of them foreground the philosophical concerns quite like this. It's a very peculiar, one-of-a-kind effort. I think it's aged really well. I wasn't sure how I felt about it in the 90s, but I love it now.
I do too. I'm surprised I had never saw this as a Lily Taylor nut. I think when I saw I Shot Andy Warhol, I'm like, oh my God, Lily Taylor should win awards and just, you know, be the queen of cinema.
Yeah.
As far as I'm concerned, like Tarantino talks about how he just like immediately fell in love with Lawrence Fishburne after seeing King of New York. That's kind of how I felt after seeing I Shot Andy Warhol. I'm like, I mean, obviously I'd seen her in Say Anything and things like that, but you know, seeing her in that lead performance. So I'm surprised I never went back to catch up with this, but maybe it was because it was hard to find.
It came out on VHS, and then I feel like it sat out the DVD revolution until Arrow put it out on Blu-ray. Maybe it had an overseas release. I can't remember, but it was not an easy film to see on DVD. You know, so I think that kind of, you know, added to it, kind of disappeared. Same way as like when we talk about What Happened Was, like there were certain films that, like, you know, were part of that indie thing that like hit VHS before DVD was like a given in home video, and it just kind of slipped through the cracks that way, even though The Addiction, you know, certainly like star studded between Lily Taylor, Christopher Walken, Annabella Sciorra, and even, you know, Sopranos, Edie Falco, you know, you have like a lot of names people would recognize.
Yeah, when I saw Edie Falco, I'm like, oh, is this going to be like if Hal Hartley made a vampire movie? I don't know.
Yeah.
Because the way people talk is really interesting to me in this movie.
Yeah, no. I mean, it would have come out at the time when Hal Hartley was at his power, you know, his most powerful in the industry as well, I guess. But it is a horror movie. I mean, it has like, you know, explicit violence, and it has like a very horror movie kind of denouement, but...
That scene where she's basically like deciding to embrace her addiction, and, you know, at the same time she wants to overcome the physical needs that she feels. And but it's like that one point where she's, I guess, like in a closet or kind of in a confined space, that she has a breakdown of sorts, and it's like a very possession like moment involving her decision not to succumb to salvation or whatever. And just like, instead, I'm just going to accept the fact that I'm an addict and burst into ultraviolence at this dinner party late in the game is really amazing to me.
Yeah. I mean, I thought of things like Rabid too, as far as like the way the disease is spread in a way that feels like a code for like a sexually transmitted disease. But it is, you know, but I think that certainly like drug addiction is something that can be, you know, introduced by partners and shared. And, you know, I feel like it still works primarily as a drug metaphor. But and even the way that like someone like Walken's character is introduced, like, you know, I've kind of found a way to be at peace with it. But, you know.
Yeah. As somebody who, you know, took an existential philosophy class early on when I went to college and just sort of like consumed all that stuff, not just because it was required reading. I was like, oh my God, Kierkegaard, Sartre, you know, all this stuff. I was just kind of like that. I was devouring all that stuff. And so whenever it sort of comes up in something like Waking Life or The Addiction, I'm just kind of like, aw, it's like comfort food. the way people think and talk in these movies.
Yeah. I mean, I feel like The Addiction was one of my first exposures to what I guess they now call elevated horror, as far as like something that was like a horror movie, but also, yeah, quoting Kierkegaard or, you know, whatever. Like, I mean, like something that was like black and white and, you know, had these ambitions or pretensions to something much more sophisticated than what was being sold as horror, you know, at the time. And yeah, it's a fascinating film. And actually, I would recommend, if you haven't seen it, the is it Speaking with the Vampires? Is it the that short film he did from a couple of years ago that was made for the Arrow release of The Addiction? But it's a documentary where he talks to Lily Taylor and Christopher Walken, you know, about that. And I think Joe Delia too. But like, he talks to people that were involved with the making of The Addiction, but they talk about things beyond just the movie. And it's like, they talk about addiction themselves. Like, they talk about Ferrara's drug use and Lily Taylor's drinking, I think. And it's,
oh, good. I found it on YouTube. Cool.
Yeah. It's on YouTube. And it's on that Blu-ray as well. But yeah, again, like, you know, we can get onto the subject of Ferrara's documentaries a little later, but like, you know, it feels like his feature documentaries in that it kind of, it's more personal and autobiographical than just simply, you know, reiterating some facts about the subject. Like they feel like home movies sometimes in a good way. But yeah, no, the Addiction is one that I think I underrated when I was younger, and now it's kind of grown into one of my favorites of his. I was going to say, you know, after The Addiction, I think to some extent that there's a chapter closing with The Funeral, which is the last film he did with Nicholas St. John as a screenwriter.
That's probably at the top of my list to catch up with, and I will. I'm almost thinking, and we didn't really announce this properly at the top of the show, but we're likely going to be able to see zeros and ones within the month, within, you know, probably likely by Thanksgiving. Mm-hmm. So we might just record like a quick half hour bonus discussion on zeros and ones and put it on Patreon. But I was also thinking of just briefly catching up and sharing my thoughts on The Funeral, because I know a lot of people put that one in pretty high regard.
Yeah. Now, The Funeral is a great film, and maybe kind of goes along with King of New York as the most accessible film, because it has that connection to, you know, mafia crime family stories like The Godfather and Goodfellas and things like that. And it has like the most star-studded ensemble, you know, you could ask for. I mean, yeah. Everyone from Isabella Rossellini to Vincent Gallo to Benicio del Toro. I mean, the leads, the brothers, you know, Christopher Walken, Chris Penn, Annabelle Sciorra, you know, just phenomenal cast. And it's, you know, you haven't seen it, so I can't, you know, we can't go too far into it. But yeah, it's like, you know, it's a family, like the three brothers are involved in crime and set in the 1930s. And, you know, Walken is kind of more kind of cool and controlling. And Chris Penn is kind of this, you know, got this crazy violent temper. And then Vincent Gallo, you know, is kind of getting swayed by radical politics. And so it creates kind of a tension. You know, if you haven't seen it, I don't want to spoil the, because maybe we'll talk about it later, but it's a really, I don't know, it's an engaging, film with a very, dark ending.
Hasn't it been easy to find, or was it never given a proper release? It almost sounds like another Addiction kind of scenario.
I mean, I have a French Blu-ray of it. I don't know why. It hasn't. I mean, but that's like aimed at the French market, so that the scenes that are in Italian aren't subtitled. That's a little frustrating. I don't know why it's never come out DVD, or it has a DVD through Artisan, but it's like full frame. It deserves to be treated more respectfully in English language, you know, home video market than it has been. I think if it ever came out through a company like Arrow or Criterion, that it would probably be reassessed as a major work. I mean, Ferrara fans tend to hold it in high regard, and it does feel like the end of an era because, you know, after that you get into much murkier waters with The Blackout, and The Blackout is, you know, that's where you get into like distribution problems. First of all, I mean, I don't think The Blackout came out on home video until like early 2000s, like straight to video, I think. And it's, you know, that's a film about like Matthew Modine as an actor who has substance abuse issues and a conflict with his girlfriend. And then he goes out and something happens with a local girl while he's like visiting a film production in Florida that his friend Dennis Hopper is directing. And then it cuts to years later and he's kind of sobered up and in a new relationship. But when he tries to explore what happened that night in the past, you know, problems ensue. So it's got like a thriller-ish kind of plot, but it's, you know, again, tackling that theme of addiction and debauchery in a real either captivating or kind of drowsy kind of manner. Like it feels like, again, like the things that feel like artistic choices might also feel like the drug addict, you know, drug addicted artist, you know, like the chemicals informing the work. I mean, I don't know if that's a cruel thing to say. I mean, I like it. I don't know that it, but that's how I read it at the time that I saw it initially.
I'm surprised it took him this long to cast Dennis Hopper. Like that seems like a match made in heaven. And you would think that they would have probably worked together at some point a lot sooner.
Yeah. I mean, Dennis Hopper was on the wagon at that point. So Ferrara was certainly not. I don't know what that relationship was like. I didn't look into the making of it so much, but I mean, they are two wild men of the cinema, but I think that Ferrara was in his, I mean, the stories that he tells in TOMMASO, I mean, Defoe's character tells him in TOMMASO, I think are stories from his time in Florida making The Blackout. It's definitely,
that makes sense. Okay. Yeah. I was trying to place that, like what era that was probably.
Pretty sure. Yeah. And I think that this is around the time that like a lot of relationships start to fray. I think that Joe Delia leaves the Ferrara team with the next film, New Rose Hotel. Like old collaborators start falling away around this period. I mean, this is like, you know, like I said, we already are out of Nicholas St. John's screenplays, and then, you know, again, it's hard to know how much of his personal life being kind of rocky impacts the films, but that, you know, they. You know, he continues to keep soldiering through regardless, but he follows that up with New Rose Hotel. And New Rose Hotel is a William Gibson adaptation. And again, is a, you know, murky and atmospheric, you know, probably a lot more cryptic than, you know, it needs to be as far as just following the story. And what's radical about that film is that it's the story of like a you know, these guys that are trying to get this kind of like scientist for a company to, you know, defect and join up with another company. Like it's kind of like corporate, like espionage in a way, maybe. But like, and they're using a young woman played by Ozzy Argento to seduce him and get him to like leave the company and join up with this other company. But it's, you know, what's radical about it is that it has this kind of melodrama, this love triangle-ish kind of situation. And then it ends with like what feels like 15 minutes of flashbacks to the previous, you know, part of the everything leading up to it. And it's like not like even recontextualized. It's just those scenes played exactly the same way, but just as memories. I just remember when I first, I'm just like, this confusing story, and then at like a half hour of flashbacks to that confusing story. So I just remember thinking, like, what is it? But I've come around to really appreciate it, you know, as an experience. Like, it's, I think it kind of works for me now. But the first time I saw it, I found it completely alienating. At the time, I thought further evidence, like, maybe this guy's just lost his mind. I don't know what's going on. Like, why would he structure it this way? But it's, you know, Christopher Walken is Willem Dafoe is the two leads, and this is the first, you know, of multiple collaborations with Dafoe. First film with Ozzie Argento, who, you know, he got involved with romantically, and she was also in Go-Go Tales, which we can get to. But like, it's, you can find pirate copies of it. I know that rarefilm.com at this time has a copy that you can stream for free if you're curious. I don't think it's got a Blu-ray release anywhere. But
I think it's on Amazon Prime, I think.
Oh, maybe it is. Yeah. I don't know. It's like not an easy film to recommend because it is kind of dense and confusing, but it's got a certain kind of sleazy art film atmosphere that is, you know, very much on brand for Ferrara if you already like his stuff. I think when you get to RXmas in 2001, it feels like a slight retreat from the haziness of Blackout and New Rose Hotel. It's a little bit more of a New York crime story, but even that,
if you, I see in it. All right.
Yeah. Andrea Di Matteo, you know, it, you know, Sopranos mm-hmm, yeah. fame. And, you know, it's another drug dealer kind of story like King of New York, and it's dealing with hostages, but it's so much more, laid back and concerned with ritual and atmosphere than like the exploitation movie type thing that he did in the 90s and the 80s. I mean, or, you know, it's definitely, I don't know. I think it's an enjoyable little B movie. Like, it's not like a major work, but it's enjoyable, as a crime drama, I guess. I don't know. I mean, I wouldn't want to oversell it, but it's a nice watch. I don't know. It's kind of a minor film for me, but
you know what's interesting though, you mentioned his music videos and things like that.
Did Ben Folds
there's
five.
One that I that's what I was going to talk about, because I love that song, and that it's one of my favorite albums of that year. And I saw this video, I'm like, yeah, this is definitely Abel Ferrara. There's little touches of his lighting and the casting of Gretchen Mol. I was kind of like, this is really kind of cool. I wouldn't say it's like, you know, a must see, but it's certainly interesting. And I can't say enough good things about that song, because I always thought it was beautiful and kind of amazing. But
yeah, it's not a collaboration cool. I saw coming.
Exactly. I never would have thought Ben Folds and Abel Ferrara, match made in heaven. But still, it's obviously really interesting just to see what he brought to the short music video world.
No. I've watched a bunch of his videos, and that was one of the standouts.
But that's kind of cool.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, I think if you know Ferrara's films around like the time of King of New York or Bad Lieutenant, like, you know, or like nightclub scenes and party scenes, and like the way he shoots kind of party atmospheres, I mean, that informs a lot of what I see in his music videos. I mean, that kind of not like slightly decadent nightlife, you know, urban kind of vision, you know. But he's not front and center of them the way like, say, David Lynch would be when he gets music video kind of assignments. I mean, I think that, yeah, Ben Folds Five, I mean, you can recognize Ferrara if you look for it, but it's not like I don't know, I wouldn't think of that, you know, part of his filmography, even the way that Paul Thomas Anderson, you know, videos feel like you know, real obviously Paul Thomas Anderson. But
I never would have, I mean, it's funny, like, yeah, I never would have thought the collaboration between him and Haim but now seeing the trailer for his latest film kind of makes sense.
Yeah, it makes more sense.
Yeah.
But so like so then he goes from RXmas to Mary, which is one of my favorites that's like hard to see now.
What a cast.
Yeah, well, I want to say Mary was the one where I just felt like, all right, maybe they've just stopped trusting Ferrara to even release these films anymore. Like, I don't think that has ever come out in America on home video. I don't even know what kind of, I think it had like a very limited theatrical release. But that's just shortly, I mean, that's like the, I guess he had read an interview with Barbara Hershey where she said she hadn't quite gotten fully into the spirit of Mary Magdalene and felt like her performance in Last Temptation of Christ wasn't quite what she hoped it would be. And so it's this story about this kind of acerbic filmmaker, actor played by Matthew Modine, who's making a movie that is kind of conflated with something like The Passion of the Christ or Last Temptation of Christ, but like a Jesus movie, but like an edgy Jesus movie. And then his Mary Magdalene actress is played by Juliette Binoche. And when the film wraps, she can't break the character. Like, she feels like she needs to go on a spiritual quest herself to figure things out, and like just leaves the industry and leaves show business to kind of do some searching. Meanwhile, Modine brings the film back to show in New York. It's arousing all this controversy. And there's a journalist played by Forrest Whitaker who's going through his own kind of crisis of faith, and he's going to spotlight this film, but he becomes kind of obsessed with, what this actress is, you know, doing like on her own kind of spiritual journey. And I don't want to spoil anything because it's, you know, I'm assuming most people haven't seen it that are listening, but like, I don't even know where you can find it streaming, let alone, you know, I had a, someone made me like the, I don't know, ninth generation copies of that and Go-Go Tales, like, you know, that are like real murky and like have warnings about, you know, property of such and such. Like, I mean, it's not like, I think there might be a DVD like in Europe, maybe UK for Mary, but it's I don't know if it's like a rights thing or what with those films, that and Go-Go Tales, but they've never really, even that with an all-star cast, I think they just don't feel commercial enough to the labels that handle these things. I don't know. But that's, you know, I think as much as the Nicholas St. John film's like a film that's about like spiritual questioning and yearning for enlightenment. And so it feels like, it feels kind of tied to those earlier Ferrara films, but he's not constricted by like genre so much. Like, it's not a crime story like some of the earlier ones. So I can see how it might be tricky to market even with that cast, but it's an interesting, maybe the best, you know, like lost film of Ferrara.
Curious about it because I know this is a silly cliche to say, but I could watch Juliette Binoche read the phone book. So I'll watch anything with her in it. And
yeah, and Modine is doing like probably the most unflattering quasi-Ferrara surrogate character. Because I mean, because on the one hand, it's like I can't tell how much it's like, satirizing Ferrara, how much it's like, you know, referencing Mel Gibson, who's, you know, Passion of the Christ was probably, I think at one point they were talking about using footage from Passion of the Christ as the film that he directed, but I don't know if Mel Gibson agreed to that. But like, it kind of comments on The Last Temptation and Passion of Christ kind of controversies. But I don't know. It's definitely an interesting film that I would say is mandatory if you're like a student of Ferrara. Like, that's one of the ones not to skip over if you can find it. Go-Go Tales is also kind of it's great, but it's very different. It's like more of a comedy. I know that he once described it as like Cheers meets Killing of a Chinese Bookie. You know, it's because it's like a I think it was like something he tried to get off the ground for a long time. Like, at one point he was thinking like it could be a TV series. At another point it was going to be like an off-Broadway play. I mean, it's very much rooted at one location and characters coming and going and hanging out kind of thing. Like, it's a hangout movie more than Ferrara's other movies. And it's the most amiable of spirit, you know, as far as like it's a, it kind of ties to Fear City in a way that it's about, you know, this guy who runs a go-go club and like, you know, money is a problem. And so it's got like that connection to Fear City, but played more as a, but even I thought of something like Bad Lieutenant because it's like, you know, what kind of means is he going to have to come up with the money to save the day, you know?
This must have been the film that he was alluding to during the Conan O'Brien interview, where he towards the end says, oh yeah, this is going to be a TV show. It's going to be about a go-go dancer. And it's going to happen.
But I guess what he was thinking is like, you know, it was going to be like an act, like, like a show shot at a go-go club, and like if you went to the club, you could be in the show.
Yeah, that's right. Yep. He mentioned that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Really interesting interview with Conan O'Brien. I'll put that in the show notes.
Yeah, no, it's legendary. But yeah. I think that Go-Go Tales, I mean, again, it's like this cast that's like Bob Hoskins, Matthew Modine, Ozzy Argento, Sylvia Miles, a great Defoe performance. But like, you know, like it's a sunnier film than a lot of these. Like, it's more overtly comedic, and it's a nice little movie. Like, I wouldn't want to oversell it. Like, I don't think it's quite the serious work that Mary is, but of the quote unquote lost Ferrara films, like, it's definitely like a nice surprise if you can find it. I think there might be a DVD out for that somewhere, but not in America. I don't know. Again, like, I don't know what the right situation is that keeps those films out. Out of circulation.
That's really interesting. Like, it seems like during the 2000s, that seems to be the case where it's like, oh, he made all these movies, but you can't find them.
Yeah, well, I think that he kind of fell out of fashion critically in some circles that like were like, you know, like the Variety, Roger Ebert kind of like mainstream critics. I mean, there were definitely like critics that always, you know, put him on a pedestal and still do. But I think that as an art house director, he was no longer hot. And it's like, you know, when that happens, you know, like I think of people like Peter Greenaway, that like the films just stop coming out here. Maybe that they get financing from sources that, you know, want certain kind of sales to be made, or they won't sell it. I think people like Bernardo Bertolucci has films that kind of disappear that way. Like, just the way that things are financed, like, he's not working in the Hollywood system. And so I don't know if the money is coming from sources that want a certain amount upon return, or they just won't sell it. So I think that like no US, I don't know if IFC Films was involved in those films or not, but like, I feel like no US deal was ever made. And so they just languish in obscurity, even though there's a lot to like about them if you're a fan of Abel Ferrara.
Before we get to the next one that I've seen, which of the documentaries from the latter period of this decade do you think is the strongest, your favorite?
That's hard to say. My favorite of his documentaries might come a little bit later, which is Piazza Vittorio. I kind of like them all about the same. Chelsea on the Rocks, Napoli, Napoli, mm-hmm. Napoli, and Mulberry Street. I kind of like them all about the same. But they're all...
Yeah, I liked what I saw of Mulberry Street. I found it relatively entertaining. I just watched a little bit of it. But it's interesting that he had that relationship with that actress that shows up in this next movie.
Oh, which one? Oh, yeah. Well, the thing with that, with Abel Ferrara, documentarian. So, like, I guess what happened was he was going to be an interview subject for Chelsea on the Rocks, which is like this series of interviews with people that used to live at the Chelsea Hotel, and then like some like fictionalized reenactments of events that happened there. Like, you know, I don't know that the world needed another Sid Vicious, Nancy Spungen thing after Alex Cox did it. But like, yeah, but it's like a, you know, it's an amiable, like, you know, shaggy, rambling, full of heart kind of documentary, and that's kind of what he does. I have no idea if they work for non-converts, because it's not like when Spike Lee or Jonathan Demme made documentaries. Like, Ferrara is definitely a character in all of them. So in that respect, it might be closer to like how Werner Herzog, you know, engages in the documentary field, where it's like, you know, the director is often a clear, you know, character in them. I mean, maybe not like the central character, but he's always kind of present in them. And, you know, but I mean, you look at something like Mulberry Street, and it's like ostensibly about the, San Gennaro, street festival in New York, but it's also just about Ferrara, like wheeling and dealing and hustling and talking to people and mixing it up and talking about deals and complaining about the screenwriter that is claiming credit for Go-Go Tales. And like, I mean, it's like, it's oversharing, you know, in how he's just, He has no filter, or he leaves these things in that just lets you check in with Abel Ferrara as much as you're checking in on the, you know, the festival itself. And,
It feels like a fly on the wall kind of experience, where it's like, oh, wow, I'm really seeing shades of this guy in a way that I hadn't anticipated, you know. And but it's interesting too.
Yeah, I mean, you look at something like Vittorio with the the Piazza Vittorio that comes a little bit later, and like, I mean, it has footage of him kind of badgering the interview subjects, like, I mean, as much as it has like the interview subjects themselves, like, has him kind of engaging with them and arguing with them and, you know, mixing it up with them. And But yeah, every single one of his documentaries feels like that. I think the one that I saw, Searching for Padre Pio, is maybe the least combative of the Ferrara. Like, I mean, he's kind of just quietly listening to these stories and trying to, work out his own angle for what, you know, the film, feature film version he's talking about making. But like, all of his documentaries are, I think, at least worth a watch and maybe a more approachable vision from Ferrara than some of his, you know, journeys into degradation and debauchery. They show another side of him that's like this warm, grizzled old survivor. You know, I don't know at what point he kicks the drugs, but it's like they feel like they all feel like post-addiction films to me, like where he will comment on those years, but they feel like a little bit more, I wouldn't say more focused because they do feel kind of rambling in places, but
yeah, they are meandering at times, but it's but compelling, you know. I had a mixed response to 444 Last Day on Earth,
which I love.
I think I can see myself loving it more now that I know what I'm in for. I always make that like my excuse where it's like on a first viewing, I wasn't sure how to, you know, absorb it. But now that I know what I'm in for and how things play out, and certainly it's an interesting movie to watch now.
Yeah.
when people were like isolated and on the verge of thinking the world was ending more or less, I really love just the idea of, you know, spending time with two people trying to process, you know, the fact that the world is going to end and how they deal with it and, you know, dealing with their insecurities and the way they process all these different emotions. And certainly there's, you know, a lot of passion and there's a lot of misplaced anger at certain points and really just like yelling out. Like Defoe has a really great moment where he's just sort of talking to himself and on the roof of his building and like, you know, he's trying to deal with this crazy thing that everybody in the world's going to face sooner than later. I don't think there was as much attention paid to Shannon Lee, the woman that he's with, Ferrara's companion at the time. But again, like dealing with his addiction late in the film, there's, you know, sort of a nice meeting that he has with some old friends down the street in another building. One of them is Natasha Lyonne. Mm-hmm. I think I really like that scene a lot. I don't know. Maybe it was a little too isolating, or it's just like uncomfortable in the same way that it probably would be in that scenario. And you know, some of the footage of you know, what's being shown on the TV, I found really interesting too. And like saying, like, you know, Al Gore was right. So right. Yeah, the ozone layer and all that stuff. Yeah. I wouldn't be surprised if this happens years down the road, but you know, nevertheless, again, you have Willem Dafoe as your main character. He carries this thing pretty well throughout the entire film, and it ends the way you kind of expect it to end. And you know, why not? A lot of filmmakers do want to make their own sort of apocalyptic drama. That's also, you know, self-reflective in the way that we'd get to later on with Tommaso.
Yeah. But, I mean,
yeah, I liked it. I didn't love it though.
Yeah. I mean, this is one that, I mean, when I saw it, I didn't see Mary and Go-Go Tales until like I got bootlegs of them later on, and I didn't see his documentary. So for me, it was like a 10-year gap between RXmas and 444 Last Day on Earth. So it felt like I wasn't sure what I was even going to get from a new Abel Ferrara film at that point, because I thought, you know, like, maybe his films were kind of hard to see for a reason. You know, I wasn't sure like what I was going to. And so it was kind of a nice surprise that it was so personal and grounded. And in a lot of ways, I feel like it's going to be impossible for me not to see it as a trial run for Tommaso.
No, definitely. And it's, you know, shot in one location practically.
Yeah. And it's like Abel Ferrara has Willem Dafoe playing his surrogate. And it's, you know, again, like his much younger real life companion is the lead actress, you know, is the companion of the Defoe character. And it's, you know, very much like you feel like you're in the, I mean, it's a little less claustrophobic in TOMMASO, but I mean, you do get a sense of like that apartment being the main place we stay in them, even though I guess,
yeah.
More so in last day, 44 last days. Then I thought about things like from the late 90s, like Last Night and Book of Life and all those films that were like, you know, end of the decade kind of, you know, portraits of the apocalypse. I even thought of Melancholia, which
sure.
Was that the same year? I think it might have been.
I think so. But, yeah. But I mean, and also like his integration of something like Skype is really well used in this film.
Yeah, but it's like that insecurity over having a much younger partner and mm-hmm. also just that kind of, like, you know, you're always going to be an addict, even if you're clean for a long time. And so, like, just, you know, like, on the last days, is he gonna like, get high? Is he going to give in one last time to the old demons? Because, you know, the world's going to end. Why not? You know, I mean, it's in a way that like TOMMASO also tackles those themes, but like without even the, you know, the disaster movie science fiction kind of element of, you know, the apocalypse. It's just, I mean, that just kind of leaves you with the character and his own kind of insecurity. This is got a little bit of ties to genre, but for the most part, it feels just like the most clear window into what he really is feeling. Of any of them, even more than Dangerous Game. I mean, up until this point, this feels like the most autobiographical film. And at the time, that was just kind of like, oh, wow, it's like, not only is this surprising, but it's coherent and clear what he's feeling. And it's the only film that he's the sole screenwriter other than TOMMASO.
That's a good point. Yeah.
I don't know if there's other uncredited writers than he takes full credit or not. I don't know what his writing process is like, but
it's an interesting movie to watch now because it does feel like it was filmed in the middle of a quarantine, you know?
Yeah.
Because it's, again, very few actors in a single location and, you know, it could be a play, basically.
Yeah. I mean, it does feel that way. And, you know, you have things that resonate with the old film. Even like the fact that she's a painter kind of resonates with Driller Killer. Mm. I mean, but it's a, yeah, I think it's, I think one of his major films. I didn't think that the first time I saw it. I thought it was just like, oh, that's I kind of like that, you know. But I didn't. It's one that it grew on me, you know. And now I see it as one of his. If you're looking for autobiographical content, then I think it's one of his major films. Like it wouldn't be like what you throw on at a party. I mean, you put on King of New York or something like that. But I
yeah,
mean,
if, yeah. But you know, but I'll watch it again in the future, I'm sure, and maybe get even more out of it.
Yeah. But the I don't know if you had anything to further you want to say about that one before I
don't think so. Not off the top of my head. I you know, it's again, I'm a sucker for end of the world movies. So it's like his Miracle Mile, maybe, you know?
Yeah. Yeah.
And I'm fine with that.
Yeah. I think after that, 2014, he has two movies that come out that year. Welcome to New York and Pasolini. And, you know, I mean, that was, I mean, I don't know. You haven't seen them, so I won't go long on them. But just that the Welcome to New York is the one that's based on the Dominique Strauss-Kahn scandal, the French politician who you know was said to have sexually assault a maid, and the big legal battle. And I think that the legal aspect of the film is why it's hard to see now. I'm not sure. I could be wrong.
I think
wrong.
I read that somewhere. Yeah.
Yeah, because it's pretty damning. I know that the real life figure, even though they changed the names, was like, you know, outraged and wanted to take legal action. And I don't know that it ever came out in France because of this. And, you know, setting aside all the real life elements, it's one of Ferrara's maybe best films in that it, you know, just that portrait of boorish, horrible male behavior. It's like the Bad Lieutenant with a lot of money, you know, like I mean, essentially, right. You know, it's essentially like one, all of his most horrible male characters, but like given all the power in the world to be their absolute most evil. Mm-hmm. And then being taken down, you know, by New York, by cops, by, you know, you know, the good guys in this case. And then you're kind of put in the shoes of, like, you know, the main character in prison and humiliation. And so it kind of puts you in, like, different places as far as, like, who you, you know, relate to or identify with. But it's pretty powerful. It's a little bit long, and it's, you know, not a fun movie because it does deal with, like, A, like, debauchery, and then B, like, legal process. So it's not, like, escapist, but it shows, like, that Ferrara had, like, by this point, like, you know, total control of his faculties. A great performance from Gerard Depardieu, and just as brave as Keitel, I would say, maybe even braver, because it really shows him, you know, in a pretty unglamorous way. I mean, just naked, as well as, like, the character itself is such a horrible character. And this is one that's substantially changed in the R-rated versus unrated version, as far as, like, it casts some doubt about his guilt in the R-rated version, where it's, like, pretty cut and dry case for him in the unrated version. So I think that might even be, like, a legally motivated kind of change in the editing of the film. But it's...
I'm curious. That's another I'll put on the list.
Yeah, I mean, you won't have fun with it, but you might respect it, I think, is what I would say, knowing your taste and knowing the film. I think it's definitely, I mean, how I described it, you know, as far as, like, it's pretty grim going, but I think strong. Pasolini, by comparison, is really subdued, and I was kind of surprised, because I was going into it thinking, like, oh well, you know, Ferrara plus Pasolini, like, this is going to get into some crazy kind of territory, especially because it's dealing with the last days of Pasolini's life before he was murdered, you know. And it has, like, this it's about the filmmaker, poet, novelist, public intellectual, you know, Pier Paolo Pasolini, and it's kind of about his final days. It has, like, these reenactments of interviews he does, and visual depictions of projects he was working on at the time, like one of his unrealized films. And it also doesn't shy away from the fact that he's, you know, fond of picking up, you know, young boy prostitutes, like those rent boys, you know, his sexuality is shown as somewhat predatory. Like, it's not like a completely fawning kind of portrait of the man. But, you know, I mean, it's balanced in that way. But it does portray his murder as more of a hate crime than a political assassination, which I saw this at the New York Film Festival, and the Q&A pretty much boiled down into one guy yelling at Ferrara and Ferrara kind of not letting it go because of that decision, because there are some people that think that, you know, Pasolini was killed for, intentionally killed because of his views and, like, political reasons. And maybe because of the last film he made, Salah 120 to Sodom, and, like, the political, statement that is making. But, regardless of whether or not you believe that, you know, he was killed in a hate crime or not. But I think that it's pretty compelling movie. I wouldn't say it's perfect, but it's Defoe is fantastic as Pasolini. And it's thankfully that did come out here and protected by Kino Lorber. This is around the time that he starts working with Kino Lorber, who have put out, you know, a few of his films on home video since then, including The Projectionist and TOMMASO, and I forget if they put out Siberia as well. But, like, they it becomes a case where he's being protected by a label that wants to treat his work respectfully, which is a good thing.
Yeah, we need more of that out there for sure.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So that's, I think, you know, at the time I went to Pasolini, I thought this could be, like, one of his great last statements, but now it feels like, you know, a warm up for the maturity of something like TOMMASO, which we can talk about.
Yeah, no, I mean, that's, you put this pretty high on your list, and I was kind of, I'd seen a number of Ferrara films by the time I've caught up with this, but at the same time, I was a little confounded by some of the more surreal touches late in the film. Mm-hmm. And didn't necessarily think they were strong, or it was more perplexing. And I kind of went, well, I don't dislike it, but I didn't feel as as overwhelmed with, you know, the sense of this is a great film. Yet, I think IndieWire described it as a micro-budget Birdman, which is weird. But I guess I can kind of see that in a weird way. But it's like, I don't know. It's one of the more humane. Like when you binge on a bunch of Ferrara films, and you know, there's I wouldn't say there's a lack of humanity in a lot of them, but certainly something like Bad Lieutenant is, you know, certainly a challenge in terms of how much debauchery you have to experience. And this is kind of like the opposite of that, where it's a little bit more intimate, and you know, Defoe plays the title character, and you know, he's in you know, a 12-step rehabilitation program, teaching an acting class, and all the while trying to embrace, you know, domestic life with another younger wife and a young daughter. So it, you know, you kind of get like bits and pieces of, you know, almost like, just I wouldn't say in a meandering style, but just various slices of, this is like the closest he's made to like a slice of life character study.
Yeah, totally.
And I kind of appreciated that. And certainly, I don't know how Defoe keeps getting better and better with age, but he's had quite the streak around this time. And I want him to start winning awards, damn it. You know, like, yeah, when, you know, Florida Project, Lighthouse, this, why hasn't he been given like some, I mean, I don't know, maybe those aren't the types of films that win Academy Awards, I realize, but still, I feel like he deserves like way more recognition and respect. And something like this is kind of, like a high point in his career, and certainly basically playing Ferrara. You know, there's an intimacy here that's really profoundly beautiful at times. And certainly there's those moments in the AA scenes, like you talked about, that are very revealing and yet very humane. And you know, again, an insight into the creative process. Like at times he's scribbling down ideas for what I assume is to be Siberia.
Yeah. Yeah. That is definitely Siberia.
Yeah. Which I didn't see, but at the same time, I'm like, yeah, that has to be it. Like we watch, some research videos that he's watching, stuff involving bears.
Yeah, which I didn't know that, you know, the first time I saw it, I hadn't seen Siberia yet, so I didn't know that he was like literally putting that film into the plot of TOMMASO.
I'm not sure about the ending. In terms of the I don't even know if Defoe was 100% on board with that choice, the crucifixion.
No, he was not. He may or may not have warmed up to it. I don't know. I wouldn't say that all of the imagery at the end, like the Christ imagery, all totally works for me either. I think it's a little bit of an overreach when you get to the last act. Even the explosion of violence feels a little bit abrupt compared to something like some of his earlier films that end in explosions of violence, like The Funeral. Like this feels a little bit more out of nowhere, but
yeah,
it doesn't bother me somehow. I can just forgive that. That's like, I'm like the lieutenant. I'm forgiving, you know, things, you know, whether or not I should, you know, but like I kind of, I mean, for me, this feels like, for so much of the running time, the best film he's made, that if it goes off the rails a little bit in the end, I can still kind of just go with that. Like, he's trying some things that may or may not work, you know, but it's not like, doesn't destroy the movie for me. I mean, it just kind of like, okay, well, I still haven't completely been sold on him on the cross at the end, but, I do like when the daughter is dancing to Sophia Loren after that. So it kind of leaves me on an up note, but,
that's a wonderful final note to end on for sure. And yeah, I think until
that point, it feels like his Pain and Glory, as far as like Almodovar's like late career kind of film, as far as like the one time bad boy of, you know, his regional cinema is now kind of like an old survivor who's no longer, you know, gonna be the rebellious young Turk on the scene, and he's just kind of in a contemplative mode. You know, and if Ferrara being Ferrara, you still have like, you know, these moments of just like, you know, him dancing with the nude woman, or like all sorts of things that like feel like I mean, maybe I think of someone like Fellini as far as like, you know, no matter how old you get, you can still be like that randy old devil, you know, that, you know, that Ferrara is never going to be completely respectable. But, you know, I love how it is just the rituals of the acting class in the AA meeting. And we see like these little seductions that he plays out without really, you know, initiating a proper affair away from the woman he's with. But like, you know, Defoe is constantly out to seduce, whether it be like, you know, ingratiating himself with the people at the market or, you know, students or, you know, people at the AA meeting. Like he's an old seducer and addict. And, you know, while he stays away from the drugs, he still has that reflex to seduce, which I don't know if Ferrara has that too, but I mean, you know, he's definitely somebody that, you know, he's still just like 444, still kind of struggles with the disconnect with his, you know, younger companion, you know, and like, you know,
yeah,
they
there's
don't
certainly a fear of losing the younger companion. Yeah.
Very much so. Yeah. And so maybe the seduction is also a way to like act out that insecurity. Like I've still got it. I can still pick up women, you know, if she leaves me, or I can still, you know, I'm still the charming old rogue that I always was, you know? But I think that this is like, yeah, I mean, when he's talking about stories that probably happened to Ferrara, you know, making the blackout, like it feels like the most autobiographical of all of them. Cause it's like, you're practically, and he's working on Siberia. Like there's like so little to separate it. I mean, we talked about Bergman Island. It feels like that kind of level of like, this is only slightly reimagined what his life is like.
Yeah.
And I think that that's so interesting that
it'd be a good movie for his therapist if he has one, because it's, you get like, I mean, it's not a movie that feels like therapy, but it's like a confession at times, and yeah, just an examination of these random feelings he's having. Because like, I don't know. I mean, maybe he has anger issues, and that's why we see that, you know, that sequence where you know, he's yelling,
he blows up at her on the street. Yeah. It's awful. Yeah. I mean, it's, and he seems like really, you know, insane. I mean, there's all the scenes like when he finds the Pakistani man drunk on the street who's been yelling, and he goes and has a moment with him. It's like all these little digressions that don't feel like they are necessarily part of a to B to C kind of plot, but they all kind of just add to the overall tone and feel of the movie, like as far as like almost documentary-like sequences kind of mixed with things that are clearly scripted. I mean, I think about lines like we don't have relationships, we take hostages, you know, as a way to describe, you know, that kind of personality. And, you know, it's, you know, you could say that about like half the characters in the Ferrara's films, you know, as far as like that being their approach to life is very self-involved and very like needy.
Yeah, it's similar to a conversation I had with a friend about codependence and like her reframing it as inevitable when you're that close with somebody, and kind of like going, it's, there can be a healthy form of that as opposed to like me automatically going, oh no, it's terrible, it's not good, because then you become too dependent on the other person and then you lose your sense of self and all that stuff. So I like that monologue that the woman has, and certainly I think a lot of people have covered this idea in film and their art, where is it okay that I'm married to this person and trying to, you know, basically evolve and hopefully grow up when there's all these other sort of primal instincts and just addictions and things that have defined me as a person that I have clung to all my life. They're kind of going away more or less, but they're also still there, like haunting you at the same time.
Yeah. It's an interesting work. I mean, it's funny. He's somebody that was so identified with New York for so many years, that it's interesting to me that he's essentially an Italian, you know, director now. I mean, he's based in Italy. A lot of his films are set in Italy. You know, I think that for him, maybe New York is a place where a lot of bad shit happened, and I think he needs to have that distance. But, you know, I think that's, I remember when Scorsese made, I think it was Raging Bull, but like King of Comedy, one of those like films that like he wasn't sure how people were going to take it, and that if it didn't do well, he was just going to maybe flee to Italy and make, you know, documentaries about the Saints. Like he was going to like become a new Roberto Rossellini kind of character. And I think of that when I think about Ferrara, like how, you know, when Ferrara's career in American film seemed to be kind of hitting a tough spot, like he, and, you know, partly because of the drugs, he just, you know, he fled and cleaned up and reinvented himself, or not reinvented, but like, you know, reclaimed his life, you know, and career. And yeah. I think grew as an artist. I mean, in ways like, I don't think he could have made TOMMASO in the '80s, you know, or in the, you know, like, I mean, that's, I love the exploitation films and, you know, like Miss 45 and things like that. But like, I appreciate that he also has this kind of interesting, kind of rich personal filmmaking side that he seems more in control of now than in the earlier attempts at it. So it's very, you know, interesting to see what he will make next. I mean, Siberia, I can touch on because you haven't seen that one. And that one is kind of a little bit
harder. I didn't read a lot of good things about it, and, you know, disappointing because, again, it's Defoe and it's the follow-up, but...
I kind of like it without thinking that it completely works. It's definitely one of the more obscure efforts. In some ways, it reminded me of maybe like Cat Chaser or something, and that it's like a which we didn't really talk about, but like the you know, it's a character who's kind of abandoned his old life to like live in some, you know, other part of the world with his own business. In this case, it's like a guy that like opened a bar in Siberia so that like he doesn't even overhear his own language being spoken. Like, he's encountering Russian clientele in this little bar that he runs. And, but then it's just like he's experiencing these memories and fantasies, and it gets quite surreal. I don't know that it totally works, but I'd say it's, I don't know. Like, it's not uninteresting if you like Ferrara, but I'd say it's one of his weaker films, and definitely like a come down after TOMMASO. But I also read some of the reviews that really trashed it, and it's like, well, I think it's more interesting than you're giving it credit for. But yeah, it's definitely like a harder sell than even TOMMASO, let alone you know, the more commercial.
Yeah, and I don't know the plot for Zeros and Ones, but I'm curious to see him work with Ethan Hawke. That's what's really the driving force for me to, you know, make an effort to see it sooner than later.
Well, you know, Ethan Hawke was originally supposed to play the lead in 444 Last Days on Last Days.
Yeah. Okay. Now I can see them working pretty well together, especially post First Reformed, you know.
Oh yeah. Yeah. He's in Chelsea on the Rocks. I mean, I could see them fitting like perfectly well together. I mean, and I would say that like keep an eye out if you're a fan of TOMMASO and or Siberia for Sportin' Life, which is the documentary that Ferrara made while promoting those films with Defoe during the pandemic. I think that's the last thing that he made that we can see. And I think IndieWire has a link to it. Like, they maybe have exclusive streaming rights to it or something. I'm not sure. It's like an hour long, but it's... Again, like all those Ferrara documentaries, like this shaggy, rambling, amiable kind of thing. But it shows the warm friendship that Defoe and Ferrara share. And, you know, Defoe in particular is so articulate always when he talks about his craft and his approaches to things that I think it's I don't know that it will necessarily make Siberia any more approachable to people that find it a little bit too baffling. But it's enjoyable, and it has a lot of Ferrara playing rock and roll on stage as well.
Oh, okay. Well, that's interesting. Yeah.
Yeah.
No, but like I said, we might catch up with Zeros and Ones and talk about that one further, because, again, I'm very curious about it. I guess it's more of a terrorist thriller, possibly, from what I gather, just looking at like the general synopsis of it.
Yeah.
But it was made during the lockdown, apparently.
Well, I never read about, you know, his films in advance. I just go in cold, and, you know, I tend to like them. So I'm excited to see it. I can't wait.
Yeah, same here. And overall, I'm definitely a fan. Certainly the ones I watched, for the most part, I really didn't, even the ones that didn't connect with me personally, I like you mentioned, they all have strengths and reasons to watch these films for sure. Like, there's nothing I absolutely walked away from going, oh, that was awful. I wish I hadn't spent my time watching that. You know, even something like Dangerous Game, where moments of it didn't sit well with me necessarily, and I didn't think it all came together successfully in the end. There's, you know, a lot of insight into how he approaches the art of filmmaking to me that makes that movie worth seeing, and definitely shouldn't have been dismissed the way it was. So, and yeah, I feel that way about a lot of his work. I think everybody should check out, you know, just a number of the titles that we brought up, that they even sound remotely interesting to you.
Yeah, no, I mean, I would say that every one of them is worth a watch. And unfortunately, you know, a film like Mary, you know, you might have to do a little bit more digging, but you know, maybe one day these things will become more available. I mean, that's always the hope with a filmmaker like this. I think that, you know, I think maybe like someone like Sam Peckinpah, you know, when they're no longer around, I think a lot of these films will get reassessed in a positive way that were maybe had mixed reception in their initial release. I find, just as in my own experience, going back to a lot of the films that I was so on, you know, years ago, I think have only grown richer for me. I mean, think of something like China Girl, especially 444, you know, and so something like TOMMASO already feels like one of those great elegiac latter day kind of works that, you know, I don't know if he can top that one, but, you know, I'm excited to see him try. Kind of feels like the way I felt that First Reformed with Paul Schrader, you know, just kind of like, oh shit, you had another one of those in the chamber. I had no idea. I thought you were done making your best work.
I know, right? Like the these filmmakers keep going, you know, and I'm always interested in, especially when once you become, and a lot of the directors I've covered on this show, I almost feel like not necessarily like a loyalty to keep up with what they're doing, but more of a curiosity and a hope that I can keep up with. Like, you know, it's why I made an effort to go see The Card Counter in the theater, just because I'm like, oh, I really love Paul Schrader's work. And but again, similarly to how I experienced First Reformed, I liked it but didn't connect with it entirely as a whole. Like, there are things about it that I kind of went, I don't know if I like that choice or not. But I bet if I watch it again, I'll feel differently.
Yeah, I forget if you got more out of the First Reformed on rewatch or not. But yeah,
I did for sure.
Yeah, I think, I don't know. I mean, I knew the auteur theory has its problems, and I think that certainly with someone like Ferrara, when you have figures like Nicholas St. John that are like so essential to the work, that it becomes a complicated, muddy thing, and you know, notions of the cryptic male genius kind of filmmaker is, you know, kind of an unfashionable idea, I guess, with, you know, in film discussion circles. I mean, I know that like a few people that I've crossed paths with over the year, like Ferrara is their favorite director. I've never been that kind of guy with him, but I get why. I mean, there's definitely not another career that really feels like his. And he's such an idiosyncratic survivor that it's easy to admire him even when not every idea works. You gotta admire the hustlers that stay in the game, you know, despite like every obstacle.
Yeah, no, for sure. And I can understand why people consider him a favorite or put him in very, very, very high regard. And it makes sense. And certainly my top three films reflect my love, and that I believe if they're not all five-star masterpieces, they're pretty close. And for me, my top three Abel Ferrara films would be, and they're very obvious choices, I would think, but number three is Bad Lieutenant, number two is King of New York, and number one is Ms. 45.
Yeah, I mean, I can rank them, but I'll just say, like,
you don't have to.
Ms. 45, TOMMASO, and King of New York would be my go-to first three that come to mind, but...
Yeah, and TOMMASO would be my number four.
Yeah, I think
the addiction would be number five. So I might as well just give the top five.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know if I can rank them beyond that. I mean, that's already kind of. I mean, that's leaving out a bunch. So yeah, I mean, you've heard me talk about them all just now. So I mean, I feel pretty strong about a lot of them. And even the ones that I feel like, you know, R.X. Smith or Cat Chaser, which we didn't really talk about. they're interesting. I mean, like, there's not like anything that I think is like, oh my God, why did he make that?
Yeah, I know. And I figured, like, you know, with a filmography that extensive and certainly his reputation and the fact that you watched everything, I was like expecting there's got to be a stinker, you know?
No, I really don't think so. I mean, something like Siberia, I would say doesn't quite work. But I mean, I would rather have that than something that is dull. Like, you know what I mean? Like, it's not dull. It's just like this weird overreach. And I feel like it could one day work for me, but it just, if I'm being honest, it's still kind of like a little bit bewildering to me, that one. But, you know, I mean, if taking that versus some of the films we've talked about on the podcast, like, as you mentioned, Schrader, like, it's not like Dying of the Light or something, you know, it's not like a fiasco. It's just, I don't know. He might just be reaching a little bit too far on that one with the surrealism of it. It feels like a little bit left field, but I don't know. It's a nice try, I guess, but it's best I can say about it.
Well, that's the thing too, is nice tries, you know, swings and misses are sometimes interesting in of themselves. And that's, you know, even like a favorite director like David Lynch, I'm certain that, you know, there are moments and certainly films that he's made like Dune where you kind of go, oh, that didn't entirely work for me, but it has elements that I find interesting.
Yeah. You know? I think the cooking of the hot dogs to come undone in the Duran Duran concert video for me is the nadir, but I mean,
Yeah.
Cause hot dogs come undone too until you cook them. I get it.
Oh my God. That's so bad. Whoa. Oh boy.
Yeah.
All right. Well, thanks so much, Bill, for coming on. This was a great talk. It's so weird how you get nervous because, like, really, are we going to have that much to say about some of these films? And I feel like we did a pretty good job. I'm pretty happy.
Yeah, thank you. It was a lot of fun. I never know these things. But I hope people got something out of it. I mean, he's one of my favorites.
And where can we find you on the internets? I'm sure you'll be back again in the future, probably even early next year, for another director that we'll probably just discuss and figure out who that'll be.
But, yeah. I mean, right now, And supporting characters is still on hold. I've been working on a commentary that I can't say what it is. So that's kind of taken up my time when I'm not watching Ferrara movies or New York Film Festival movies. I don't know. I mean, www.nowplayingnetwork.net/supporting-characters is where you can find my old episodes, and I'm going to be on a bunch of podcasts coming up. So that's kind of what I've been doing. But you can find me on Twitter and Instagram.
Did you record the Lost Highway episode?
Nope. Next month I'm doing that. And
I thought it was this month.
Yeah, we moved it to November. We're doing, so I'm going to be on, Projection Booth on Lost Highway. I'm going to be on Genre Grinder talking about 70s horror films that, like, slightly deeper cuts. I get, well, not that deep cuts, but, like, you know, like the, left field 70s horror choices. I'm even going to be briefly on a pretty big podcast that used to be on the Narrow Plane Network, but I'll tell you about it off.
Okay. Nice tease. Well, thanks, everybody. Like I said, next month, probably maybe pre-Thanksgiving, we'll see, but the next director is going to be Sarah Polley because I love her, and my guest will be Kate Blair. And she was on for the Celine Sciamma episode. Of course, all three of Sarah Polley's films are worth talking about and rewatching. So I hope you will all join in on that discussion. Please visit us over at directorsclubpodcast.com and send me an email at directorsclubpodcast@gmail.com. And nowadays, I'm Jim Laskowski on Letterboxd and Twitter. So find me there. And thanks again, Bill, for joining me today. This was a lot of fun.
Thank you so much.
Forever, my darling, my love will be true. Always and forever, I'll love just you. Just promise me, darling, fire in my soul, dear. forever.